The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the season three finale of the SWN podcast. We're going to blow the roof off this place. There's going to be a fire. Sound the alarms. It is Caleb Valhalla's return to the podcast. Welcome back.
Hi, I'm glad to be back. We've got some stories. So,
oh, yes.
Things have been busy. I've been a busy man.
Absolutely. I mean, I was looking last time we spoke. I can't remember the date what it was, but I know it went out October 2020. So I'm assuming I was really organized at that point. It was about September time we probably chatted. You have been super busy since then. Yeah. I don't even know where to start. So we'll just bandy about. I'll ask you how you are first. How's it going?
Yeah, not bad. I got my booster today, so... that's a thing. I have to get laid, like they had to lay me down for it beforehand. I'm not great with like that kind of stuff. So I always warn them, like, I'm not good with needles and all that stuff. So she was like, well, do you want me to lay you down for it? And I was like, well, last time I stayed sitting, they gave me the second jab, and then I kind of sat there for a few minutes, and they're like, do you want to lay down? And I was like, okay, go on. I know you probably want to lay me down. So they put me in this little chair and wheeled me around, and Mrs. Valhalla was laughing as I got wheeled past her and sat on this, well, lay down on this thing, this little bed in the Montrose Town Hall. So they just laid me down the first time straight away here and gave me the jab then. And I was actually okay. I wasn't too bad this time. I didn't need to lie down because I was already lying down, I guess. so yeah, that was a thing. I feel a little bit spacey at the moment, but I'm sure that's fine. I'm sure I was it was the same after the second one. I was a little spacey after that, so
I'm still waiting for that booster. Well, there's done doesn't seem to be any round about here. I go into the app and just put in Elgin, and there's like no, you're not getting one. Fine. I don't leave the house anyway, so it's I don't think I think I'm safe.
I think the woman was looking at me like, yeah, don't die. Like, you're about 16 stone. I don't want to pick you up off the floor if you go down. Like, yeah, fair. Let's lay me down first.
I always think you get weird looks when you go, oh, I don't like needles. And then you're just covered in tattoos. And think,
yeah, they're always like, oh, but how do you get tattoos? I'm like, that's a trial by fire getting a tattoo. I'm not great with that either, but I just suck it up to get it done. And it's there forever afterwards, so.
I always forget how sore they are until I think, oh, I'll get one. And then I about halfway through, I'm like, oh, God.
I swear, it gets worse as you get older as well. Every single one I've got is worse and worse, I swear. Unless I'm just getting to the really hard parts to get done now or something. I don't know.
Yeah, well, when I got the wee Lucha mask there, the skull mask thing, nice. I was laid down for that, thankfully, because I was just sitting there thinking, I hope she doesn't ask me questions because I think we're going to pass out at this point. Yeah. And then she like stopped. I thought, oh, it's fine. I must be finished. Oh, that's the outline done. Shit. Yeah. I'm going to die. I'm going to die here.
my last one here was, I can't remember how long it was, maybe 6 hours or something. But like the last hour, it was starting to get pretty rough and he was up by the elbow. He finished that off and he was like, okay, time for the white detail. Like, okay, cool. So, you know, that's when they wipe it all down and they dry it off. And then he was really nice. He put some like numbing stuff on it. And even with the numbing stuff, it was agony when he was like at the elbow doing white detail and stuff. And I was like, how sore would that have been without the numbing stuff? Because that was still bloody sore. So
I'm not ready. I'm trying to finally get this like just a random sleeve of nerdy shit. And I'm just worried about the elbow because that one will not even need it. And it stung like fuck to get there. Yeah. And I was, I can't imagine what's going to be there. I'm really tempted by a hand tattoo, like just there. And every time I looked at it, I go, no, that's really thin. I don't think I'm not going to like that either. I'm just going to just finish the pudgy bits first and then just work my way to the hard bits.
Yeah.
So your journey. Yes. I've written down where you've been. I didn't write it in order because that would be far too organized. but we'll just go with I'll throw ICW in first because you're on the WWE Network now.
Yeah, that's wild. That's something I didn't expect to happen this year. I mean, at this point, this year was kind of like a nice little bonus, but like, yeah, I'm happy with how things have turned out. And that that call to ICW was, yeah, unexpected, I'd say. Just kind of, I think it was like a week and a half beforehand, I got the message just asking if I was available. I was like, yeah. Thankfully, we're back to contact training, so I was like somewhat confident. And it wasn't too long before what was going to be my scheduled first show anyways. So I was almost there with where I wanted to be condition-wise, and like, you know, how I looked. So I just had to dial things in a little bit tighter than I wanted for that week and a half to look decent enough for showing up on the network. But I mean, you know me, I'm still not 100% happy with how I looked, but you know, I was like, yeah, it's as good as I'm going to get at that point. Yeah. And like,
After all that work, though, trying to get yourself in shape, in a shape that you want to, and you come in to see Sheikh El Sham and you go, what?
Yeah, he's in good condition. He's looking good. Yeah, that was fun as well. I don't know if you will just go into the story of everything, like, or do you have any questions directly? We'll freeball it.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just kind of obviously got the shout. Gave, you know, spoke to Andy about it. Just like, you know, to calm me a bit as well, because, you know, first show back and it's going on the network and I'm like, Christ, am I ready for it? And he was like, no, you're ready, don't worry, just go for it. I think we turned up and, you know, it was nice to meet everyone there. I spoke to Dallas. He remembered me from when I helped out at the Aberdeen show. He was recognized me and remembered me from that and was like, yeah, if you wrestle half as well as you look, then we're on to a winner kind of thing. I was like, okay, cool. He remembers me. That's nice. I didn't think he would remember me. You know, meet everyone, get changed, go get some promo shots done. Then putting the match together with Sheik, and he was a top guy. Really easy to put something together with. And we had the kind of just of like looking at the other people that were on the show that day. We were like, right, well, this is really the big man match of the night, is it? So let's just go in with that and go for it kind of thing. I think we had like 8 minutes. And when I originally got there, I don't think I was meant to be getting an entrance, but then they were like, nah, you're getting an entrance now, definitely. So I don't know what changed at that point. I don't know if they just saw me and thought, oh, wait, no, give the guy an entrance. I don't know. So I was like, cool, that's great. But that eats into our 8 minute slot. So if you watch it back, you'll notice I don't fuck about with that entrance. I'm just like, get out, do a pose, get in the ring, I do a pose, and I'm like, let's go. Because I knew Sheik's entrance takes a bit of time. He's got to get his entrance over. That's, you know, part of his stick there. You know, he's got that kind of slow, methodical kind of entrance and I think that was his first time in front of the ICW crowd as well. So important for him to get that over with them. So I was like, okay, cool, I'll just do my entrance as quick as I can. We'll get into the match, you know, go for it kind of thing. So I was quite happy with how the match went. There was one or two little bits that kind of annoyed me that I thought, oh, I should have done that better, this bit here. But I'm always like that. I'm never 100% happy with a match. I'm always overcritical, shall we say. But I mean, that's how you improve, is it? Yeah, good feedback as well backstage afterwards. A lot of people seem to enjoy it. So
when I saw that you had posted that you were at the show and on it, I was like, Jesus, he's already. It's just like, it is, because not only, I mean, they have brought in quite a lot of guys through like GPWA and FPWA onto their shows, but it's still weird to me when I'm seeing guys in Northeast appearing in ICW or shows, even though that you're kind of now training in that middle spot in Fife and Glen Rothes or wherever it may be, but yeah, you're kind of in the middle now with that. But what was it like getting? I mean, the ICW crowd's changed now. It wasn't as rowdy as it used to be for one reason or another. But what was it like getting in front of an ICW crowd for the first time then?
Yeah, they were great. I think when I was speaking to Andy, he was saying very much like they're the crowd that's there right now are the ones that want to be part of, you know, rebuilding things and making things, you know, as big and successful as they can be there. That's great. The fans are, you know, wanting to be part of that. That's cool. And they were really, really fucking sound with me. They were, I think that's where the Skull chant really originated as well. Like there was a few people in the crowd kind of started chanting Skull, Skull, Skull. And I was like, I'd had that in my head, but I didn't know how to like implement it. And then when they started it, I was like, yeah, it's a thing. That's definitely a thing I need to run with. So again, that's really where that came from. And I just started taking it, you know, elsewhere now, and, you know, using it before like doing the Hell Ride or things like that, you know, just, or when I'm, you know, setting something up, you know, getting that skull chance, something that I think's pretty cool. But yeah, I didn't expect that. I didn't expect the reaction from them. They seemed into me. That was cool. That was really cool. Especially like, I didn't think anyone would know who I was. So they probably didn't, but they just liked the look of me or something. I don't know.
Definitely. I mean, the look is striking, especially in Scottish wrestling in general. Yeah. It is definitely a striking look. And it's like when and Scotty appeared in ICW, there was only these three people. Like it was Kyle Kaylee, or not even Kaylee, just Kyle and Mark, maybe, yeah. that would have been like, yes, and everyone's going, no idea who this guy is.
Yeah. At that point, Kaylee would have been like, no idea who this guy is.
So. But yeah, so was that your first taste of a crowd then? That was the first one back since...
Yeah, that was the first one back. That was October time that was filmed. I think it worked out being about 2 weeks before Hijinks, something like that, because I remember I thought, oh, I need to push my diet, you know, a little bit cleaner for this like week and a half to get ready for it, because I was on track for Hijinks, but I had to fast track it a bit.
Hijinks. We'll work our way around back to that, because I'll have a lot of thoughts about Hijinks. The other place you've done pretty well at is Fair Say.
Oh yeah.
You know, just coming in, world heavyweight title match. We call it a world title. That's my bad. There's heavyweight at the moment, or interdimensional if you're from Asgard. But yeah, so you came on, first match heavyweight title match against Dickie Divers, and you become FCW heavyweight champion.
Yeah.
So yeah, how?
I hit him with the Hell Ride, and then I covered him, and then the ref counted 1, 2, 3 and he gave me the belt. But yeah, no, that one caught me off guard a bit as well. The obviously I was set to go there before COVID ruined everything, but I think in the long run, I think COVID actually probably helped me somehow, like losing this time period, but like I've used it quite effectively, I think, because I was like, right, I'm just going to hammer the training and eating and, you know, pack on a bit of mass. I'm going to really dial in like the brain part of wrestling, you know, the all the seminars I did, all the kind of thought I put into the character. It's felt like it's all kind of paid off. The shows since lockdown, it's been worthwhile. And as much as it sucked losing that time, it's great that it's kind of, I feel like that has kind of put me 2-3 years ahead of where I would have been if we just kept rolling. Probably helps as well that each company has kind of had that time to sit back and have a look at their roster and their plans and what they want to do. And they've maybe had a look and said, well, why don't we use a guy Caleb? And that's happened, you know, a few companies. And for FCW, I guess they kind of had a look and thought, right, this guy's putting in a lot of work. He was good before. He's hopefully coming back even better. Let's you know, put our company on his shoulders and you know, let him, you know, go with it. And that blew my mind. The fact that company's putting that kind of level of trust in me. Whoa. Okay. Cool. I won't let you down, kind of thing. And hopefully I won't. Obviously, the first show was, the first show back for them, the first show overall was a big success. It was a good crowd. Again, I didn't have to start the skull chant there. It was started by one or two who'd seen me at Discovery not long before, where the skull chant got over big time, and they were starting the skull chant before I did in that match. I was like, okay, cool. It's a thing now. It's great. So yeah, we're rolling with Viking shit, you know. AEW's got their cowboy shit. Scottish wrestling's all about Viking shit right now.
Well, we'll get back to your adventures in FCW, because everyone will be listening for one particular part of it, which, you know, I'm going to tease them a little longer. We're not going to get straight into it.
Let's look at show one just now, because working with Divers was great. He was super putting that match together. And obviously me interjecting my thoughts, him with like a good structure for it all. I think he had the guts of the finish kind of lined up, and it was one of those like, oh, hopefully the crowd will react. And then they did. They reacted exactly how we wanted. Got the right reaction, which coming in, it's like, I need to get myself over with this new crowd, just debuting somewhere anyways, but now I need to get myself over enough for that they give a shit that I've just won the heavyweight championship for that company. It's like, will they care enough? And the way they reacted, I guess they did. Probably basis of you know, how we put the match together, hopefully that they cared in the end, even if they didn't beforehand, if they didn't know who I was. So
yeah, I mean, like you were saying about the restructuring, I suppose if COVID didn't happen and all the other stuff did happen, we do say a lot that up in this little tiny portion of the country that wrestles on the Northeast, they just get kind of forgotten about. And you're right, you probably would have just kept rolling up here, and you might get someone going, oh, let's bring Caleb down. But might not have happened. So yeah, that restructuring and that going, and then be able to look out and see who's putting in the work. And you're quite good at putting out like videos of your character and your Pizza Hunt and your and all that kind of stuff, that people could see what you were before they actually saw you wrestle as well, which is always a good thing.
Yeah, I think that Am I a God vignette kind of got a bit of attention from some people as well, that kind of saw, oh, okay, that's the character, that's what he wants to do, and that we wouldn't mind that on our show. Maybe I did get you know, some feedback on that, and you know, it was widely positive. So I had fun making it. People seemed to enjoy watching it. So
we'll go to Discovery then before we come back to FCW, because like I say, we're jumping all over. I should have written down I just knew where you were, and I didn't even look at my notes. Like I said before, I don't know if I said it on the start of this, but yeah, I did listen to our previous chat, and I was like, nah, I hate my voice so much, I'm just gonna wing it. I'm gonna guess what I spoke about. So if anyone else wants to hear it, they can do. It's in the archives, whatever word that is. Discovery, though. So I watched that FCW show, and I watched the first Discovery show back as well, because handily they've both put them on YouTube. So Discovery is probably up there, one of the biggest, maybe I would easily say top two companies in Scotland right now. What was it like getting a shout for that?
Yeah, delighted. Discovery was one of the places I definitely wanted to get. I don't even know if we mentioned that in the last chat or not. Obviously, I can't remember exactly what we talked about. And now with all the different Mickey's Mosh Pits, I really have no clue what stories I've told in that anymore. Not because I've been blackout drunk like Vago, but, you know, just because there's so much chat that we have off screen sometimes, and it's like, I can't remember which, you know, what I talked about on our first chat. I can't remember what I spoke about on any of those chats, and it's like, I hate watching myself back, so I probably won't go dive through that. So so Discovery, the call from them was like, oh wow, okay, that's cool. I thought I was going to get a booking or two, that would be great. But then like they seemed quite keen to take me down and get some promo pictures done with like their new kind of core roster going forwards. And I was like, oh, core roster going forwards, that sounds like, you know, more than one or two maybe bookings. So then speaking to them and hearing like the plans they had, you know, for Caleb, the character and the where they want to go with it, I was like, oh, this is awesome. Like speaking to Randy Valentine, he possibly gets the character even more than I do, it seems. He's constantly feeding me little things, and we end up chatting back and forth with like just again biking shit or, you know, Caleb nonsense that could work. And he's actually the guy that mentioned about the face paint that I've started doing, and he basically said to me like, have you considered doing face paint? And I was like, yes, I've actually been practicing some just during lockdown randomly every now and then when I get like 10 minutes at work. I'll just go you know, do a little bit of face paint and be like, that design's okay. And then so I did that for like a week or two, just kind of getting ideas for what the face paint design could be. And I just sent him like some pictures, like, oh yeah, I've actually been thinking about this. And he was like, yeah, I think it'd be great if you came and did it at Discovery. And then I did it at Discovery for their second show and was like, oh yeah, I think that's a winner. I think I need to do that all the time now because it's added a bit of something to the look, I think. But yeah, delighted getting a shot there. The first show, I'm quite nervous before going out. I'll get in my head and like I'll just like constantly go over the match. This is what I want to happen, you know, visualize and then make it happen, whatever. But I get really worked up and anxious and nervous. And my wife was backstage with the baby as well, and she saw me and she was like, are you like this before like all your shows? And I'm like, pretty much. She was like, wow, I didn't know you were like this. And I was like, yeah. But then like through the curtain, gone. Caleb takes over, you know. So hey, that Gabe, one,
if I remember rightly, you almost went arse over tit and right at the start as well, on your own beverage.
oh yeah, that was at FCW.
FCW, yeah. I'll just now that, yeah, aye. But so okay, FCW, we'll come back to that one. And yeah, so okay, Discovery, yeah. Go back to Discovery.
So Discovery, yeah. So I'm all worked up, come through the curtain, and it's gone. The crowd reaction was awesome. That crowd was great. In fact, all the crowds have been great. But I do specifically remember at the time just thinking, man, that crowd's awesome. Got in, had a fun match with Alistair Caron. I hope I said that right. Yeah, had a fun match with him. Got the right reaction. Like I said, the skull chant got over. After the match, grabbed my horn. Alan Smith Slayer with a thing of beer, pours it into my horn. He leaves himself a little bit, like we clink our horn and glass and, you know, chant skull. And then I go and draw the raffle with him in the ring. Yeah, and the crowd was totally into me at that point. I was like, oh, this is awesome. Got backstage. I got backstage afterwards and I was like, yeah. Like beforehand, I was like, geez, is it worth it for all this, like how I feel beforehand? And then I got backstage and I was like, that's totally worth it. Totally worth all the anxiety and all the stress and the nerves. It's, yeah.
So that must be a big honor doing the raffle, because it's like it's such a, I don't know, I don't think Alan understands why either, but it's such a big part of Discovery shows. It's what color is the ticket and all that kind of stuff. So yeah. So to be part of that is quite big, I suppose, for your first show anyway.
Yeah, it's definitely a way to get a character over if you want to get a baby face over that's, you know, a large enough character to kind of do that thing. And I think Caleb is the mighty Caleb, when especially there, like I felt like that's the most the characters really came out at Discovery, that especially like that first show. I felt like I was like totally relaxed, just being as over the top with it as possible, but not like hokey over the top though. It was like just about hitting that line and stopping at the right point. I think maybe people are watching this like, nah man, that was dumb, but I'm like, oh well, what can you do? Can't please everyone. I had
exactly.
fun.
Exactly. That's right. If you have fun and you show it, or you're clearly just all in on it, then people will just gravitate towards it.
Yeah, it's well. Infectious. The more fun you have, the more fun the crowd has, I think.
Exactly. So Discovery is so that's going to be one of your home bases come whenever this thing ends, and we're actually, because I mean at this point of recording, we were only recording like 7 days before it goes out, but at this point of recording there's a new variant spreading and who knows what's going to happen next year, but in the meantime it just means I'll get more guests on because nobody will be able to go outside. That's a good no, it's the glass half full. I'll get more guests. So Discovery is, that kind of crowd as well, it's kind of a mixed crowd. They know who's coming, kind of thing. So no doubt that there'll be plenty of people who would have seen your appearance in ICW or would have seen wherever else you'd been and seen his school chants or seen you wrestle elsewhere. So they would know what Caleb Valhalla is about. I mean, there'll be a good pocket that won't have seen you before and will see you for the first time going, oh Jesus, that guy's huge. Let's support that guy, kind of thing. But it's really, I don't want to say a marquee crowd, but they do their research, kind of thing. The crowd know their Scottish wrestling, definitely more than I do at times. I would almost guarantee it. We do have questions about your time at Discovery. So this is more about the second one. You were very kind enough to put out a post on Instagram asking for questions.
Oh yeah,
and we've got Ian Skinner. I didn't read the first one he sent out. I'll be honest, I was looking at the Goblin one, and Goblin got Goblin. I think I need to clarify that for my own accent. The Goblin one, but the first one's even better. Why does Baby Valhalla not shake my hand backstage?
He's got heat with her. I don't know either. I don't know. She won't tell me, but yeah, she's just not up for shaking his hand. In fact, I don't think she shook anyone's hand backstage. I think she was big leaguing everyone. Like she was the most over person in that building backstage. So I think she was like, yeah, they can come to me.
I'll tell you, when Kelly went past your wife and Baby Valhalla at the WrestleZone show, she was like, literally, I've never heard the voice so high pitched going, "Oh, the baby." I was like, moving on. We're seeing some wrestling now. We're seeing some wrestling. Come on, come on. So, yeah. So, Ian must have watched some of their ICW stuff and seen Ian Skinner as a big Tory. That must be
That must be it. That must be it. I'm fairly certain she's got like a fuck the Tories baby grow. So, she maybe had that on underneath and was just like, Skinner.
So concurrently, and I'll make sure that it's the right order. How excited were you to throw the wee goblin about at Disco? So we did have a back and forth. We think he's referring to himself.
Oh yeah. We're fairly certain he's referring to himself, and I think you said not Mackie. So yeah, I was quite gutted actually. I was really looking forward to working with Skinner, but not to be this time. But I'm sure there'll be another opportunity down the road. Fingers crossed. Maybe even at Disco, who knows? Maybe elsewhere, who knows?
I mean, that match itself, I mean, the second question was concurrently, how disappointed were you? So you've answered that.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But in that match itself, I mean, you weren't even, you're quite the same size as like a Deacon Matthews, so it must be quite rare that you've actually got in with someone that kind of matches you size-wise.
Yeah, he's in good shape. Fortunately, me and him seem to take the brunt. Obviously, you haven't seen that match because that one's not up on YouTube like the first one. But it was great being in there with him. And in general, just Deacon Matthews is a really nice guy. As I'm sure you know after your chat with him, he's a really, really nice guy. So it turned out to be more me and him kind of taking the brunt of the other two kind of attacking us. I got jumped at the start with Griffin and Athena. They decided to jump me with that mace and go to town on my ribs. So I was a bit compromised straight away. Deacon Matthews had to deal with Griffin and Karen, who was Skinner's replacement, which was a nice little throwback actually, because it was Deacon and Griffin and the first show, and me and Karen in the first show as well. So the four-way ended up being the four of us all together again. But yeah, I was compromised, but you know, down, not out. So obviously I come back in, get to do a bit of damage, but then obviously ribs being a bit knackered from that mace, I was compromised. They could take me out with that. And then I was in and out. It was one of those weird matches where I got backstage and I felt like I hadn't had a match. It's like I had a few spots in there, but I feel like I could go like another 15 minutes or something. What's happening here? Barely sweating when I go backstage. This is so weird. Especially, I think, I can't remember what the show was before, but I remember like the previous shows I'd been getting backstage and I was like, whew, that's a tough shift, you know, like sweating, bit gassed. I'm like, oh, maybe work on the cardio a little bit, get Andy drilling me some more. That match I got backstage and I was like, man, I could go back out there. That was awesome.
But I mean, you wouldn't have been doing that many multi-man matches by that point. You would have had, I'm trying to think of any other forays. The pre-show Anarchy would have been one with Kiger, Irvin Garrett, and oh god, I should know these things. Caden Garrick?
Caden Garrick, yeah, pretty sure, yeah.
There you go. That would have been maybe the only other time you would have had that kind of outside of maybe tag matches, but even then it's 1-on-1 for the majority of the tag matches.
Yeah, I think you're right. I'm trying to think.
Of course, the famed FCW show, but that was afterwards, was it? Or
my timeline's all messed up.
Yeah, my time.
I can't recall.
You know what? It would have been handy if I just wrote down that. I usually do, and I thought, oh, it'll be fine. I'll wing it. But
I can slightly check my calendar because I've got to put all my bookings in my calendar now because I don't want to get I don't want to double book places or anything like that.
If you've got a cage match profile yet? Ah, oh, no cage match profile yet.
Oh, jeez, I'm not a real wrestler then. No. Is it? Okay, no, FCW was before that Discovery show. So I'd done the four-way there, but obviously mitigating circumstances with that four-way match.
Yeah, a little bit more adrenaline pumping through your veins at the start of that than maybe you as usual.
Yeah,
for other reasons. Another place that I've got noted down before your most recent place is Reckless Intent as well, which is another good place to get in and about. What was time like as your brief time in Reckless Intent been?
Yeah, really, really good, really enjoyable. Again, a great roster. There's obviously a lot of crossover with the roster there in Discovery right now. Quite a lot of the guys on both shows. So I've got to know them quite a bit, and yeah, really nice guys all round. The first show, me and Aspen Faith had a decent match, I think. There's definitely more to come. If I get, another opportunity up against him, I'm fairly certain. I'm fairly certain we could have a better match, and tear down the house, given one or two maybe opportunities just to, that feeling out process sometimes with someone. You're like, oh, I know he's really good. Hopefully, I'm good enough to go with him. Then you have a good match, and you're like, oh, no, but actually, we can do better. We can do better than that. I can't wait to do that again, kind of thing. So that was that scenario in that first match, and a decent little crowd for their first show back. It wasn't the biggest crowd, but I'd say it's the smallest crowd of all the shows so far. But it was a decent crowd. They were quite loud at various points. Then the second regular show was awesome. That was a really loud crowd. I think that one sold out, and they were hot for that show. So that was me, Rob Mills, and Jack Morris. My mind almost blanked. So that was great. And again, most of that crowd probably didn't know who I was, but they set it up really well. They kind of had an interview segment with Divers and Jack Morris out there. Then Theodorus came out, and they were back and forth to build up the main event that night of Divers and Doros. And then Morris, attacks Theo from behind, and management's obviously like, okay, well, if you want to fight, then we've got a match for you right now then. And then Rob Mills comes out, and Jack Morris kind of sells it like, oh, okay, I can beat him up, that's fine. And he's like, oh, no, we didn't say it was going to be a singles match. It's you've got another opponent as well. And then I came through, and the crowd popped, even though I don't think most of them knew me, but I think the way Morris sold it, like, oh my God, oh no, even if they didn't know me, they knew, okay, that's a bigger deal then. Then we had a fun little three-way match. Really looking forward to getting some footage from that, hopefully, because I really want to see one or two spots just to see how they looked back. And if I do, then they'll be shared on social media. So they might be shared by the time this is out, who knows? And then you'll be like, oh yeah, that's the spot he was talking about. You shared that on his Instagram and Twitter and whatnot. So great fun match. And just a great company to work for, really great atmosphere backstage, good people involved, like I said. They're really well organized. Yeah, top place to work.
So before we get to the bit that everyone's waiting for, we're going to get into WrestleZone because I love WrestleZone.
Yep.
And that's not, I don't think that's a secret at this stage. After 123 episodes, this will be the 123rd. I don't think it's a secret that I am a big fan of WrestleZone. So this is the Halloween Hijinks, first show back for the WrestleZone fans. For me, it was my first show back. I wasn't even meant to be there. But COVID intervened and I had to be. It meant that I could go. And you were in the Halloween Brawl, and it was a beautiful match. So I was like, get back in front of the Aberdeen crowd. So this will be a crowd that they know you. So it's not like you're going in thinking, oh, well, they know who I am, or you have to worry about that. You're going in and it's the WrestleZone crowd. So it's like getting in front of them again.
It was a strange one. It was like, I didn't know going out. I didn't know what kind of reaction I was going to get. Because obviously we know Zach Dynamite's going to go out, he's going to get booed. We know Mickey Vago is going to get a massive pop, especially with his fan club there. But what kind of reaction is Caleb going to get? Because, you know, I'm kind of in that awkward position where, you know, people like me, but they hate Alan, so they hate that Alan. So how do they react? But man, I got a baby face reaction, I think, when I came out there. It was kind of like, I was a little startled a little bit with that. I was like, oh shit, I'm babyface right now then, it seems. But it was just great to get that reaction. I remember someone saying like, oh, you could have really milked that that entrance a little bit more when I was getting feedback for the match. And I was like, I didn't expect the reaction I got. So I didn't even think to milk it out. I was just too busy like, oh my God, I got a pop for that. Okay. I just came out. And was like, yeah, and then they were like, yay! And I was like, oh, cool. Hey guys, home promotion.
that's the thing about that's the thing about your character in WrestleZone. It's in that weird spot because when you're wrestling yourself or on your own, you're just this big beast, and everyone and you kind of interact with the crowd a little bit. Everyone loves you, and then like you say, Alan comes out and just like pisses on it a little bit because he's like, you can't take your shirt off. You have to wear his hat, and you have to. he tries to make you look a little bit stupid, kind of thing. Yeah. But everyone's going, "No, Caleb's fine." How did the toot come about?
Oh, I'm fairly certain the toot was literally me just goofing about on one of the smaller shows. There was a trilogy of matches involving Alan and Damien and. To this day, I can't remember if I mentioned in the last podcast, but to this day, I think it's one of the best trilogies of matches you'll see, especially from a comedy standpoint. It was just utter nonsense. The first match, Damien managed to replace his head with a mannequin head while Alan had a headlock on, and Alan kept working the headlock until he realized it was a mannequin head. He was like, what? You know, nonsense like that. One of them was a tag match with Crusher. He was teaming with Crusher. I was ringside, and then it was Damien and Connor. Now Connor Malloy. And I picked up Alan. Like, you know when a babyface will pick up a kid and like drop kick the heel. It was kind of like that, but it was me with Alan, and I'm running at the. I was running at Damien or whoever, and he moved out of the way, and we accidentally hit Crusher, and we're like. Drop him off of that. And I'm like, oh no, I told you that wouldn't work, Alan. All this kind of absolute nonsense. I had Alan up on my shoulders, and then Connor was up on Damien's shoulders, I think. And then we like came in and they tied up on top of our shoulders. Alan somehow got his hat over his eyes or something like that. And he was grabbing my head and I couldn't see. So I was looking around, trying to get, you know, find out where we were. And then I turned into a super kick from Damien and, you know, electric chaired him by accident. It was absolute nonsense like that. So it was just kind of like, we were just throwing shit at the wall and seeing what stuck really. And I think toot came out of that. And I think that's when the hat really got over as well. And he decided, I'm going to get another hat so you can have a hat as well. And I can't believe his skills with that hat. I'm sure the other guys have talked about it, but the way he can, you know, do all these spots with a hat in it, and it's not a gimmicked hat, it's just like a, it's a regular hat, but it still somehow stays on his head. At Christmas, he took his t-shirt off and his hat didn't move. And I was like, how is that possible? How is that possible? Just absolute nonsense all around. But I think I mentioned in the first call, like his hilarity has really kind of helped me see the more lighthearted side and how to implement it, you know, successfully. So learning from him there, for sure.
Was it? I think it was on Vigo's podcast that he told the story of Joe Henry asking him what he did, and all he said was, "I'm a Swanton and I have a hat."
Yeah,
that was it.
That was it.
That's all you need. That's all you need.
Honestly, we were backstage putting that match together, and you could see Joe Henry just slowly like, okay, they really get this crowd, so I'll follow their kind of lead on that, and like, okay, it's that kind of crowd. How about this spot? How about that spot? And then he just totally got it as well, after a minute or two of like Alan explaining that. And I think we did a thing in the training seminar before that, like there was one spot where it was just like you do three front rolls to get out of a wrist lock, and I was like, you should do that, but then have Alan be like, how did you do that? And then he tries it and just can't do it, he can't figure it out, and he's like, all right, that kind of character's like, yep, they'll love that. And he's like, great. So that was really cool to see someone, you know, brilliant come in and just be like, all right, yeah, let's have some fun with this crowd. Yeah,
I think personally, from watching wrestling and all this time, wrestling is probably one of the easiest crowds to get to cheer, really, and boo, because they're in for a wee bit of a story. If bumps come, if you end up doing a big move, that's great. But they're here for a little story as well, and they want to see all that with it as well.
If you give them the stuff they want, they'll react exactly how they're meant to, and they'll have a great time. So when you try and you need to have that crowd work there, which if you don't, it's tough. They probably won't react how you want just for wrestling. You need that character and crowd work to really get the reactions from the WrestleZone guys. Yeah.
Yeah.
The WrestleZone faithful.
Yeah, if you don't bring them into the story, then they're not going to be part of it. They're not going to enjoy themselves.
I'm going to crack my beer as well for you, because we're celebrating, Billy.
Yep.
We're celebrating.
Season finale with my possibly very out-of-date John Smith. See if I've got... Oh, God, that is really out-of-date. So this could be fun. This went out-of-date August 2018.
Oh, geez. Did you get that from my mum's house? she's got some amount of out-of-date beer, so...
I mean,
you're welcome to it if you want it.
I'll see the tenants I had before. Oh, it was just July 18. It went down fine. This will be okay.
Yeah, you'll be fine.
So like I say, as long as I don't end up passed out like Vago and his one of his mixers, then I'm fine. Speaking of Vago, he did send in a question.
I don't think I've seen this one.
You know, because he sent it in DMs.
Here he goes. But,
yes, Caleb was one of this year's breakout stars, getting booked at promotions up and down the country, but is he willing to admit that he is in fact Montrose's number two wrestler after failing to beat Mickey Vago through all of 2021 and concede his place on all WrestleZone's posters as Montrose's own?
Hey, I don't make the posters, so that's up to someone else. So we'll see what happens with the poster scenario for the next Montrose show. But no, credit where credit's due. Vago, you've got a good little fan club there, and you're doing well in the old WrestleZone. I'll give you that. It's undeniable. I had a great time working with him as well, to be honest. But we'll put him over for a little bit, because that I don't think we actually discussed the Halloween Brawl, so we'll discuss it now.
Oh yeah.
That was one of the easiest matches to put together that I've ever had. We literally just had like a few, you know, moments that we wanted to get in here and there. Like I think I I said about like the sweets, we'll get sweets, we'll lay out the sweets, which I did not expect to spread the way they did. I was like, shit, they are everywhere. I just thought, I'll pour them out, they'll maybe be in a little confined spot, I'll take someone onto them, and that's so that didn't work out. They were just, every bump after that was onto sweets. And I made sure I actually asked for like the hard boiled sweets and all that kind of stuff. So that was maybe a little dumb, but to be honest, I didn't feel it at the time because adrenaline. Vigo had his pumpkin spot, which genius. Dan had his spot. So we were just like, these are the moments. Let's kind of put them in escalating order of what we think would be, you know, a nice way to tell a story. And then that's the finish, and we'll just get from moment to moment, you know, with little bits here and there. And like we thought, oh, multi-man matches can be pretty tough sometimes to put together. No, it was done in like 5 minutes, and we're like, wow, that was fun to put together, and even more fun to go do. I think the pumpkin spot, that was the thing I was thinking, oh boy, this could hurt, because he's not going to factor in the thickness of the pumpkin when he goes to headbutt me, but it wasn't too bad. The bin, the coast to coast, or what was it he shouted?
I've no idea. Probably a stage dive or something.
Stage dive, that's it. That was it. The stage dive, we'll call it. Yeah, that was into Dan, to Zach Dynamite, and then the bin kind of caught me right in the lip. I was like, oh, you fuck. He pulled me out and covered me, and I was like, yeah. But I don't mind putting him over. You know, he's got to get something as soon as he doesn't get on the posters for Montrose. That's 2 years in a row he's not put on the posters. So,
I mean, he's a renowned podcaster now. He's got
He's got bigger fish to fry. He's
at least three fans in the crowd. The Vago fan club. It's weird how all this has happened, and this break from wrestling shows and come back. And Vago's got one of the loudest reactions because he's now a podcaster. Whether he thinks he is or not is a different matter, but he's definitely got a podcast, so I think that counts as a podcaster as well.
It's an enjoyable one to do as well. I think I've been on three times now, maybe more. Three, four? So
I think maybe three as of recording. I think, is there maybe a fourth on the way? Possibly. Yeah. That's the thing. I like to think it's Vago contacted me before he even started the podcast, just asking me how I did this. And I thought, it's very easy. It's just Zoom. That's it. There's no skill to this.
Hit record.
Yeah, there's literally no skill to this. When I finish this, once it's downloaded, I will put the title bit at the front, the end bit at the end. That is it. That'll be done. So we set it up and everything. I like to think of it as like your big cousin. So everyone's got their big cousin that's a bit rowdier and a bit like that buys you cigarettes, it buys you booze, goes, go on. I feel that's what Vago's podcast is. Everyone comes on here and they're all quite nice, and they not slanderous. They don't call out anyone in particular. They don't like... Yeah. And then they don't swear because I asked them not to swear for the first one.
Unless they're Scotty Swift or Johnny Lyons.
Oh yeah, I didn't even try. It was Johnny Lyons. Yeah, I was just like
with that. Yeah,
I was just like, oh, fuck, just go for it, Johnny. I'd just go. And then they go on to Vago's, and everyone says like, oh, try not to swear on Billy's, and or try to be professional. And then they just you guys just let loose. But I suppose it's more that comfort thing, because a lot of people never met me. I'll maybe see them at a show, stare at them, and then be awkward and never speak to them in real life. So with Vago, I suppose it's that familiarity of
I gave you a wave just before that. I went out for Halloween. You got a little wave from me. I saw you. Your wife was like, oh, you can see us, Caleb. I was like, okay. I popped it back because I didn't want you to see me too much, but yeah. I didn't realize you could see down that little gap.
Well, no, we didn't realize until like right at the start when I turned around, and it wasn't the first one, it was before the main event. I turned around and there was Alan, and Alan caught my eye and just went. And I was like, right, okay, let's just. I've been caught. I'll just look away now. I'll ignore that bit. But no, that was so much. I think because I've said in another podcast, I didn't think I missed watching live wrestling as much as I did. And when I got there, it was just it was emotional. It's just twice this year I've cried watching something, and that is Spider-Man.
Don't tell me anything about Spider-Man. I don't know yet.
I was a mess. I was just in tears. It's incredible.
I was close with Ghostbusters. I was close. That was. Oof.
I haven't seen Ghostbusters yet.
It's good. I can only nowadays I can only go to the Baby and Me screens. Like they've just opened a cinema in Montrose, and it's great. They do a Baby and Me screening every week. So. I said to the wife straight away, like, as soon as Ghostbusters is on, we're going to that. We need to go to that. And it's great. You go in, there's other babies. So if your baby cries, you know, no one cares because their baby's going to cry probably. It's not quite as loud and the lights are on a little bit. So you can kind of see what you're doing or if you need to like change a nappy or something like that. So yeah, good little setup. I got to see Ghostbusters. I was happy. The baby slept for about 45 minutes to an hour through it. And I was like, oh, well, she can watch it again later. I'll tell her what she's missed. You know,
we'll have to come back again. Let's just we'll do that.
Swift stressed though because I missed the start, and he's like, he said it's a hot start, so I was like, oh, I'll need to go see it again at some point, but no idea when. Might just have to wait for it to come on streaming services or something, or Blu-ray.
That's the thing, especially with all this. I mean, cinema since it came back. I think the first film I went to see when no, I'm wrong. I think it was Black Widow was the first film I saw. Back after all this stuff, because I'm a big Marvel nerd, so it was Black Widow, Shang-Chi, and somehow the Suicide Squad got in there as well, because I didn't quite legally find a copy of it, and it died 40 minutes in. I thought, I quite enjoyed that. I'm going to go to the cinema to see it now. Nice. So
it was good. I haven't seen that one yet.
It was interesting. I think John Cena kind of just made me want to go and see it.
Yeah.
It was good. It's probably like the second best DC film I've seen. The first being Shazam.
I enjoyed Shazam. Shazam was great. That was one of my favorites from DC as well, not gonna lie.
Yeah, that would be the best one. The worst, I mean, there's so many worsts, but I watched the 4-hour uncut Batman v Superman. No, not even that. It's just Justice League.
Yeah.
Oh god, that was awful. Yeah. everyone was going, oh, you should watch it in blocks. Like, no, it's come out in one go. I'm going to watch it in one go, and I've regretted my life for it. It was so bad.
I haven't put myself through that one yet. I'll work up to it. I did go through like all the Marvel movies again recently. Just having a baby, it's like we'll introduce her to this, even though she has no idea what's going on. So we watched all those. We've watched all the Harry Potters recently, and I hadn't seen part two of the Deathly Hallows ever. And I hadn't read the book of Deathly Hallows. So like I didn't know how it ended for all these years until like two nights ago. So there you go.
How did you get to part one and not ever think of seeing part two?
I watched I really enjoyed them all, and then I watched part one, the Deathly Hallows, and I thought that was shit. That's just 2 hours of them camping and having a dance. And I was like, what the, who gives a shit? Ah, fuck this. And I didn't watch the part two. So yeah,
wow,
now I finally watched part two. And I was like, yeah, it's good in part two.
That's why it's called part one, because there's a part two to it, yeah. I suppose. But yeah, wow. And that's the other thing we end up seeing, because it's 20 years of Harry Potter, I end up going and seeing Philosopher's Stone in the cinema as well, and Prisoner of Azkaban as well in the cinema. It's been quite nice. We're thinking of investing in a view card. We've been to the cinema that often now. We're thinking, oh, we may as well save some money in this now, because it's a bit wild. Elgin, it's £9 a ticket, which is mental because it sounds awful. But like, if you use a fiver and you think, oh, you could probably get worth out of a card if it's a fiver a month kind of thing. Anyway, this isn't a movie podcast. This is a wrestling podcast. So I'll just swing back just ever so slightly as I just tease people more that we're not mentioning the FCW story just yet. So we've got a few more.
Wait, you do have a movie quiz coming up though.
I do. That is so true. Yes. So people on the Patreon would have already seen it, hopefully, or heard it.
I can't wait to watch it.
You know what? I went into it with all the questions written out, and it was far more. I'm always worried when I do quizzes because, of course, I'm jumping off the best of the Mosh Pit birthday bash quiz, and I think I need to top that if I'm doing a quiz, and yeah, it was. I didn't think it would be as exciting as it was. And it was, yeah. It's worth watching. So for those that are watching this when it releases, this will be Christmas Eve. Christmas Day, we'll have the quiz. And then on Boxing Day, we've got Scotty Swift and I speaking about his match against Super Executioner in Keith, of all places. It's just...
Was the movie quiz a no-score draw, though?
You'll have to wait and see to find out. I'm not going to spoil it. All I'm going to say, it was nail-biter. That's all I'll say about it. It was exciting. Mm. So I'll go through the rest of the Instagram questions just so I can get the screenshot off my screen and then get the Twitter ones. We've got Dean Ford asking Ragnar or Ivar?
Oh, Ragnar. Ragnar. Although I haven't finished watching Vikings, to be honest, which, again, I didn't get to like part one of something. I thought it was shit and just not watch part two for Vikings. I just literally have ran out of like time to watch things that I need to pay attention to. So a lot of the time it's just a case of I've seen that before, I'll put it on so I can watch, you know, 60% of it, and the other 40% I'll be trying to entertain a baby or something like that. So far, Ragnar, but I mean Ivar has gone a bit crazy. Where I'm up to, I can't remember where I'm up to. I'm up to like season 6, no idea. Amazon knows. Next time I go on to Prime, it'll tell me watch next. I'll be like, yeah, if I've got time.
That's the thing. I mean, I've never. It's not my kind of thing to watch. But I know as soon as I start watching it, I'll be like, so when does Edge come in? When's Edge here? I'll be interested when Edge arrives, and I'll watch it. But yeah, so. When he asked that, I was like, I don't know. I thought Eric was the other Viking warrior. I was very confused. Viking Raiders, Viking Experience. I don't know what they are. It's been a while since I've seen them. We've got Jamie Chesser, of course, wrestling referee, asking what's the best WrestleMania and why is it WrestleMania 9?
Ooh, 9.
Is that Bam Bam LT? It's Bam Bam LT.
So I think this is a recurring thing with Chesser and Scotty, that they talk about how WrestleMania 9 is actually pretty good. Or I'm not sure if it's Chesser who says it's pretty good and Scotty's not sure he agrees. Or if maybe he's actually convinced Scotty, I can't remember. But yeah, there's a recurring theme there.
I would like to apologize in case Scotty or Jamie's listening. It's Bret Hart, Yokozuna with Hulk Hogan coming in at the end.
Yeah, of course. That one. I don't know if I've got a favorite though. To legitimately answer, I really don't know if I've got a favorite. 17's a kind of classic answer. 30's fantastic, but I didn't watch 30 that year. That's the only WrestleMania I've not watched like live. And then I found out when that's when Taker lost, right?
Yeah, yes.
So I didn't watch it live. And then when I found out Taker lost, I was like, I don't want to fucking watch it. I don't want to fucking watch it. And it took me like ages to get around to watching it. And I think it was also a time period when I only watched the Rumble and Mania. I kind of fallen out of love with watching WWE. So I legitimately just watched the Rumble and Mania every year. And that was like, for some reason, couldn't make the Mania party that we had with everyone. That year for some reason, and it's like, fuck it, Taker lost, I don't want to see it. If I don't watch it, it didn't happen. But then I finally watched it like a little while after, and I was like, man, I bet this is actually pretty awesome live. And heaps of other ones. I loved like all the vignettes when they did the Hollywood one.
21, I think it was 21, was it?
Phenomenal. That one was kind of like my peak of fandom, I guess, that kind of time period, so maybe that, I don't know.
I know, 15, I've got a soft spot for 15. It's probably not the best one ever, but it was my first. So yeah. The first one's always the most exciting when it comes to WrestleMania. We've got John Mitchell's last question I've got from the Instagram ones you sent me. Who's your dream opponent for 2022? Quite a big question to end on for that section, but we'll throw it in there.
Oh, dream. I mean, dream could be like... You know, it could be anyone.
How about MLW? What's his name? Alex Hammerstone.
Is that the big blonde dude?
Yeah, the guy who's like the spitting image of you, except without the tattoo.
No, he's probably
doink doink match.
Yeah. No, probably not him. But I mean, you say dream, it could be like a returning Undertaker if it's a real dream kind of scenario. Yeah. But then. As long as he could go, which it could probably go more than enough for me, to be honest. So, man, that's such a big question. It's like dream opponents.
That's the thing now with this world that we're in. It's like before 10 years ago, if you said dream opponent, you probably stick to either your area or just Scotland or the UK if you're lucky. And now, literally, you could wrestle anywhere. If anyone could, you could be in Europe, you could be in, I mean, seeing you in Scandinavia would just be hilarious, just for the whole Viking thing to go with it.
I mean, I've had a very, very brief conversation about that, but yeah, maybe one day, who knows. I mean, there's feasible opponents I would like to have, but then even I say feasible, I didn't think I would have worked so many promotions and so many people this year. So there's like a few people that have kind of ticked off my dream opponent list this year that I didn't think I would. I mean, I say dream is probably not, it's probably not dream opponents, but it's like, you know, bucket list kind of opponents, you know. So dream opponent would be, let's say dream opponent John Cena, you know.
That's the thing.
That's completely unfeasible.
No, it's a dream. That's it. I mean, whenever I see this one thing, I mean, I've got the website and everything, but I don't really do news other than like big things or match news is not all that much schedules. But every time I see a news thing come up going, so-and-so would love to face John Cena in the future. Of course you fucking would.
Yeah.
It's John Cena.
If I'm working heel, then give me a face John Cena. And if I'm working face, then give me a heel Randy Orton. Done. Yeah.
That's like, it's the most useless articles I ever see. It's like, oh, so-and-so would like to face this big name. Well, of course you would. Why would you not want to face these people? It's just, just wrestling journalism. That's why I never call myself a journalist, because that's having to put out shite pieces like that. Right. So that was my rant out of the way. Let's get on to yours. FCW, your journey has been interesting so far. You came in for your first night. That was the night you slipped on your own booze. Water. I'm assuming it was water because it's, of course, you're professional.
Right. I ain't telling you what's in my horn.
Clips that. So you had that, won the belt. Amazing. You defend it the next night. Great. All going well. But it didn't go well, did it?
Yeah. I don't think it was the next night. It was like a week or two after, really close. But
what happened
allegedly?
Allegedly.
Everything is allegedly, because I will prefix it with I didn't see anything. This is all things I've heard from people. But people that claim to have seen it firsthand, so I'm inclined to believe them, even though the person who's heavily involved in this story seems to deny everything. So I don't know. So we turn up to the venue, looking around like, oh, that's a pretty cool venue. It's got like the kind of bleacher stands. That's really cool. It would be great if it was filled, it would be an awesome kind of venue. I think like we had one bleacher stand pretty full, and then some chairs around. Hopefully, as you know, Dundee hopefully rebuilds, we can get that place filled, and it'd be an awesome atmosphere, I think. We get there, we're setting up. I'm speaking to Divers, and funnily enough, he called exactly what happened. Like before the rings finished being put up, I think he called exactly what happens later on in the story. So we'll see. We'll have some fun anyway. So we go on. We're getting ready. We're discussing the match. It's a four-way match with me, Looking Sharp, Dickie Divers, and Asylum. So we get the match all set up, and we're like, okay, cool. As the show's going on, we hear murmurs of someone from a rival company allegedly trying to get into the building. So the person in question being Dave Lowe. No surprise. Okay, we thought this would maybe happen. Apparently, they did like a Facebook Live outside the venue beforehand. Thinking they were, I don't know, probably thinking they were like DX or something. This is Bo, by the way. Say hi, Bo.
Hello.
So that happens. You're like, okay, fair enough. They didn't let him in, obviously. So the show continues and we just get on with things. So the main event comes up. Nothing's happened. Great. One person goes out, second person goes out, third person goes out, and then I'm going out last as champion, going around the ring, my music's playing, and then fire alarm. And in my head, I'm saying, you know, try and stay fucking straight. I'm like, yeah, no, stay Caleb here, and don't sell anything. But in my head, I'm thinking, fire alarm, we're gonna have to evacuate, they're gonna have to do checks before we're allowed back in the building. Okay. So everyone gets out the building. It's, you know, end of October or something. I think it was late October or maybe early November. Someone with a better memory than me will be able to confirm or deny. But you're away to check. I see you.
I'm away to check. Yeah.
So we're outside. There's a kid crying, upset. You know, people out, you know, in the cold. We're like, fuck, this is a bit of a disaster, because we had to be out the building by 11 p.m. And we had a 25-minute curtain-to-curtain window for the main event. We had this match laid out. It was a four-way elimination-style match. We were like, you know, if this, you know, goes to plan, it'll be a good match, we're thinking. Then that happens. We're all of a sudden thinking, right, depending how long we're out here, we can't do that match. But we can't really, we're trying not to kill kayfabe. We're trying not to, like, congregate and discuss things. We're trying to keep apart somewhat. With the exception of, like, Looking Sharp, who comes over to me and he's like, Caleb, get him up on your shoulders, get him up on your shoulders. So, pop him up on my shoulders. He's whipping the crowd into a frenzy. So, they're all out there in the cold. And he's like, the people that have done this are, like, right down there. They can hear you. Fuck them. FC Dub. He's got the whole crowd chanting FC Dub. It was cool. So I've got him up on my shoulders, like, FC Dub. He's up on my shoulders, going nuts, as, you know, Looking Sharp does. The kids are coming up and they're like, oh, can we get pictures? You know, that was cool. It was like interacting with the fans. Remind me to come back to interacting with the fans as well for FCW, because there's a little story. It's not like a story, it's just like a little tidbit. But So we're interacting with the fans, and we're out there for like 40 minutes, and there's obviously kids, babies. There's at least two babies out in this cold. I'm out just, you know, topless in my tights.
on a November 7th night.
November 7th night, yeah. That was it. Remember it. Remember the date well.
Oh, sorry, November 6th. Sorry, November 6th
six,
night.
November 6th date.
you connected me there. November 6th.
Yeah, that was it. Yeah, I remember the date well. So we're outside. We're like, fuck, fuck, fuck. Okay, 40 minutes later, we get back in the building. They've done all their checks. Everything's fine. Because, you know, as you can imagine, Billy, there was no fucking fire in that building. So some cunt had pulled the fire alarm. Don't know who. But allegedly, someone saw Dave Lowe in the building. Don't know what he was doing in the building. And allegedly, he got a headbutt for his troubles from a trainee. He's wanted to live out his Bret Hart fantasy for all these years, and he turned out getting to be Vince McMahon getting battered by Bret Hart or something. I don't know. Instead,
I was going to say ends up being Bruce Hart or something.
And again, I don't know anything about any. Only stuff I know about Dave Lowe is stuff I don't ever heard. Or people had like screenshotted and sent my way. I remember the first time I saw a picture of him, and I was like, oh, this is exactly what I thought Scottish wrestling was before I got involved in Scottish wrestling. This is exactly why I didn't want to get involved in Scottish wrestling. Like, this kind of shit, this kind of weird, shitty cosplay stuff, like, not for me. Says the guy dressed up as a Viking. But, you know, at least I dressed it up as myself, you know. So that's allegedly what happened. So we get back in the building. And I'm like, shit, we got to fucking change this shell on the fly. We got like 2 minutes, 3 minutes to plan something. Like, we don't have a 25-minute curtain anymore. We've got like 12, maybe. I don't know, because we got to get the ring down. We got to get the van filled. And we got to be out here by 11 p.m. So, fuck. So we quickly gather our heads. You know, a microphone goes out to the crowd. I think he calls out Ken Caden. They do a quick impromptu promo to just buy a bit of time. we're backstage for a few minutes, like I say, and we quickly, like, we can't do elimination anymore. It's just a one fall. We can do like this first section all the same, and then we'll do this. We'll do a fucking shotgun bit here, and then finish, and that'll get us through it. But like, obviously, we get out there, we start running through what we have. You know, we've got the opening relatively in our heads, but you know, it's from there on. You know, I get a little bit lost at one point, and someone else gets a little bit lost, so it's literally just a case of like going on the fly for most of it. Asylum was really really good in there. He just, like, at one point I was lost, he just grabbed me, that, you know, just took control a little bit, and then I started firing back at various points, and it worked. Obviously, him being like 23 stone, it's quite believable he just, like, you know, grab me and chuck me out a little bit, as opposed to, you know, if I'd been in there with, you know, someone else smaller at that point. So it was good that he could just kind of grab me, take control, do something. I think someone else was lost at one point, and again, we just kind of worked it, got this match done and dusted. The finish got, I mean, the crowd were hot at this point as well. I think what Looking Sharp had done to fire them up really worked. I think they were fired up for this main event after being out in the cold in general. And I'm assuming these are all fans, Dundee based, so they maybe have, you know, an idea that it was possibly the other Dundee company that has done this and has made them stand out in the cold for 40 minutes. So, you know, but they're probably thinking, fuck those guys as well. It's the most, like, shooting yourself in the foot kind of scenario I could think of. Fucking over fans that would potentially go to your own show. Doesn't make sense to me.
It's not like he's this alleged person that's done this, Dave. It's not like he's sleek and swift and could be able to get in and out of a building so quickly without getting caught. So I don't know why he even thought it would be a good idea if he did this. I mean,
it might have been someone with him that actually did it, and maybe that's a loophole to say he didn't do it. I don't know. Again, this is all rumor and innuendo. None of this could be true. All of it could be true. But I don't know any other story or version of events where someone else pulls the fire alarm and there wasn't a fire. So make it make sense is what I've, you know.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I had no intentions of ever working there anyways. But you know, I say never. I mean, it's wrestling. It's never say never, is it? Mm-hmm. They could maybe come in and say, yeah, we've got a match lined up for you versus John Cena. Are you interested? That's a maybe. You know, so.
But, there you go, Dave. There you go, Dave. Get Ted DiBiase's, your owner's money, and get John Cena over, and you'll get Caleb Valhalla.
Caleb versus John Cena at the Caird Hall.
Hell for Lycra.
Or Randy Orton. I said Randy Orton as well. So, you know. I don't know if you could boot me as a face for SWE, though. I don't know.
Like I say, I had the rose tinted specs with them a long time ago, but when that came out and they were broken because I didn't do what I was told, and I got chewed out for it, and that was that. I was like, oh, you're dicks. Okay, cool. All right, we'll just move on.
There's far too much smoke there for there to not have been a fire or two at least. So
yeah, like I say, it's one of those things when it came out. It was no surprise. So unless someone's done a masterful job of creating a narrative where with multiple people being in on it.
Maybe we're all in the wrong.
Maybe. But if, like I say, likes of like Divers has no horse in this fight. As in, he's not, this is his second show there. So he's got no reason to particularly dislike one over the other. And I would take his word on it being an outsider to all this as a bit more concrete than but filming yourself outside the venue on the same day, what a fucking idiot.
It's a strange one. And again, one of my daughter was one of the babies outside for 40 minutes in the cold, so fuck Dave Lowe.
Yeah, that's the best way to end that particular portion of it, but What a wank.
I mean, the match was fine. It's not going to get match of the year or anything like that, but I mean, it achieved all the things we set out to do. Randy Valentine was actually in the audience that night and afterwards came up and said, you guys did really well under those circumstances, you know. So that's all we could really do. And again, the crowd were fucking great and they popped for the end. And then at the very end, Dean Ambrose came out and seemed to challenge me for the next show lined up for Perth, the start of next year. Well, yeah, end of January next year. So, yeah.
All goes on.
Yeah, they got, I mean, he got a good reaction for that as well. So, being in Dundee as well, that was always going to happen. He was always going to get a bit of a reaction. So, me versus him should be fun.
Yeah, I've probably seen it.
I should be fine for it anyways. I've got that and I've got, well, obviously we've got Summerhill Showdown in January for WrestleZone. And then there's two FCW shows at the end of January. But I am getting a little operation at the start of January. So I'm like, I should be fine, but we'll find out. I've told both companies, just have a little plan B just in case. But I should be fine.
I'll be there, Summerhill Showdown. I can't wait.
You will be there.
Oh. I will be there. I actually will be there. We've booked a wee hotel. Oh, I haven't booked it yet. We've booked the tickets and we've booked the dog. It's dog sitting. But I haven't actually booked the actual staying over yet. But
this is a good little segue into Christmas Chaos, by the way, because, you know, you weren't at Christmas Chaos.
Oh, and... don't remind me. I got the short end of the straw for that day. I was at W3L and it was not good. So let's just move on from that bit.
Well, let's say we mention it on the mosh pit. So,
all right,
we'll give you a little jab or two, all in good jest, all in good fun.
I think I've been told that I do get mentioned quite a bit in that upcoming episode. But I'll say it again just in case people do listen. I couldn't go there. I didn't have the car, didn't have transport to get there, and I wasn't taking a bus because fuck that. And I went to W3L in Elgin, and it was late. And the first two faces I saw were people that I didn't really want to see again from Dundee. And that kind of put me on edge for the rest of the show. And the rest of the show was not good either. I mean, there was good bits. I mean, I've done a review of it and I tried so fucking hard to be positive about it. Because I'm just a positive person when it comes to watching
you
wrestling.
You like wrestling, you want to enjoy it, and you always find the good things. You find,
But it was very difficult to find the good things in it.
Is that where the Bulgarian baker is?
Yes. Yeah, and he wasn't even there, so that was even worse.
I tell you, if anyone, so if that's W3L, if anyone from W3L is listening, book me as the Bulgarian baker one time just to pop Billy, please. Because I love the fact that it's different people, and I love that it would be so obvious that it's me, probably. But it would just pop one guy in the crowd.
Oh, yeah. I'm fairly certain that's the only reason why they have the baker there most years. Well, this year, of course, Brexit, they couldn't get the Bulgarian baker over
of course.
Europe.
Obviously. You know? Yeah.
But yeah, I'm sure the only, because he's never on any other tour date. Like, if they do the North, he's never in Ullapool, he's never in Wick, he's only on Elgin. So, literally, it has to be the only reason they do it is because it pops me, and me
is
only.
Is it just you, or does the whole crowd pop for it?
Oh, everyone loves it. It's a guy coming out with a mask and a bit of bread. What's not to love at this point? I mean, they might not react. I might do the reaction enough for everyone else, because it's so stupid. And every year, I think... No, that's it. The time's over for the baker. I don't find this funny anymore. And then he comes out with a baguette, and I'm like, this is fucking amazing. It's the best thing.
Brilliant.
So hopefully one day maybe there could be a talent exchange and the baker can be in at Northern Hotel.
Yeah, that... why not?
Ivory Anarchy. Get him.
Hey, I mean, you always need bodies for a rumble, so...
Oh, I think I would die if the baker... if I had the baker, Malice... and just all these kind of weird madcap characters all over Scotland appear in one rumble, I don't think I would survive. I would just be in a pool.
A gimmick battle royal.
Oh, yeah, that would be amazing. So before we actually did that, you said their FCW story about interaction.
Oh, yeah, like I that was one of the cool things. Like, obviously, up until now, I've really kind of been working kind of heelish at WrestleZone, shall we say. Well, I mean, I haven't really worked proper heel, I don't think, but like I've been, you know, getting mixed reactions, shall we say, with WrestleZone. So I've not really got much time with the crowd. So after that first show with FCW, we kind of had the, me and Ken Caden had our belts, and then we had Brody Adler there as well, who was challenging for the women's title the following show. So we were like, kind of, we finished the match, I finished the match in the main event, got back, and they were like, oh yeah, you got like a little meet and greet. So like, there was kind of like a little meet and greet with us with our titles and signing posters for all these fans coming through. I was like, I had never done anything like that up to that point. And I was like, this is cool. Cause like there was, you know, I love that side. I mean, I love the whole like kind of John Cena kind of stuff, doing all the, that kind of things and making, you know, you see the videos of like John Cena making kids' days. It's like, that's cool. That's awesome. That's what this is all about. And getting to do that for the first time at that FCW show was really cool. There was like one kid came through and his mum was like, oh, he's really shy, you know, he doesn't speak too much. And then like, we like started speaking to him, asking what his favorite matches were and all that kind of standard stuff. And then got a little picture. I put the belt on his shoulder and he was just elated. And I was like, this is the coolest thing about all of the wrestling stuff, like taking the bumps and all the forearming each other back and forth and all that stuff. That's fun, but like it was a really nice like reminder of that. Wow, this is what this is all about. And I loved that. And kind of similar at Discovery, you know, like it ended Reckless Intent, where I've been working face and I've got to do those things again, not to the same kind of extent, because that was kind of like FCW kind of organized it. I think maybe you could buy meet and greet or something on the merch or something like that. I'm not 100% sure. But then like at Reckless or at Discovery, you know, there was just fans kind of hanging about afterwards. And similar to like when I first spoke to you after Anarchy.
I was about to mention that. Yeah.
Like that was the very, very first time I'd like probably had that kind of thing. That was only my third show. I was like, oh, like I said, I put a face to a name. I think that time it was like, because I'd obviously heard of like SWN. Although I hadn't, the first time you ever wrote about me, I hadn't heard of it or like knew anything about it or reviews. But then I had like Lewis Turner from Wrestling Security like screenshot something when we threw out Bill and Alan. Like you just put something about like this Thor looking dude or something like that, and you're just like, oh, what's this, where's this from, like who's writing about this? And then like obviously that's when I kind of was showing all the SWN stuff and I was like, oh this is cool, this is like, someone's actually paying attention to what we're doing and, you know, following it and reporting on it to an extent, and that's cool. Unless he goes to W3L, so that's the kind of jabs you were getting, by the way, on the mosh pit. Just to let you know, there's that kind of, that's the type of humor.
I'll take it in good sport, because yeah, so every time I said it on the Scotty episode that's coming on Boxing Day, but every time that Kyle sent me an update or a picture, and I was just like, oh, fuck you, Kyle, fuck you, sending me these things while I'm sitting.
The Aspen Faith tweet. Oh, did you see the Aspen Faith tweet where he was like just posting the venue, the doors?
Oh, he did it for the other place as well. The first one.
Oh, did he?
Hijinks, did it for Hijinks.
Oh, I was just like, oh, I hope that's just to wind up Billy because he's not here.
Honestly, if he did turn up on that night, I would have been so disappointed that I wasn't there, but like I literally couldn't go. I mean, it wasn't even supposed to be at the first show, so you know, I've got that mapped out in my brain where I'm going next year. I'm going to hit all the big ones, of course, the big five, and then if there's like Summer Hill, Rumble, obviously, I have to go to the Rumble, Anarchy, Battle of Nations, Hijinks, oh, seven, Chaos. So I'm hoping to hit all them this year, and then if they do Huntley again or Keith, and then I'll try and hit them as well. But I'm making a point of it. I'll probably fail like the third hurdle. I'll get to Summerhill, Rumble, Anarchy, and then I'll fucking miss everything else. But
yeah, I think you need to at least send a correspondent like Adam, or get Kyle to come up for the Montrose show, just for, you know, we can get an article on who is the real king of Montrose wrestling. You know, that's what we need.
I think that's good. I mean,
the battle for Montrose.
Like I was saying to Scott, I said to Scott, it's like people might think I'm on the payroll. I bloody wish I was, because that means I wouldn't have to wait and go, Christ, my payday is 3 days' time. Hopefully, there's still tickets available at this point. But no, it's I've never been. I mean, all these things that have happened this year, some terrible things have happened this year. Most disappointing part of my year has been missing Christmas Chaos. And that's just, Oh, and I'll never forgive myself. I'll have to get the DVD when it comes out. Yeah. I suppose when they're there. But yeah, so
the event was good. I won't tell you too much about the match if you're maybe going to get the DVD. So, you know, you'd be surprised. But, you know, at one point I remember I got getting bust open, like my nose started bleeding. I have no idea. I think it was during Vago's hot tag. And I've watched it back twice and I've absolutely no idea where or when it happens. So there's just that great picture of me like carrying Alan out on my shoulder, just blood running down my nose. I'm like, that's cool. Yeah. No idea what happened. I didn't feel it at the time until I just felt something running down my face. And I was like, oh, fuck. Yeah. So yeah, who knows?
Must be the using the face paint. He must have just been going, no. No, that's my gimmick.
That's my thing. That's my thing. Yeah. I mean, I think our face paint's different enough, at least. So just, I mean, mine's Viking war paint, you know, so, and his is corpse paint, so.
But so, I mean, that means you're not even, like, I mean, now you're both battling for the best face-painted wrestler from Montrose. So it just gets the levels of this.
Levels. Backing them up.
So I've got loads of questions, but we'll get back to them in a second because I've got two more places I want to speak about before we get to those. So Pro 2, we'll go to next.
Okay.
Pro 2 Wrestling, of course, Logan Storm, who everyone I've spoken to, and I've spoken to the man himself. He's definitely a character.
Oh, yeah.
Is Logan. What was it like wrestling for Pro 2?
That was a really fun, weird day in general. So it was at Bounce Station, which is just like a big bouncy castle place. And we kind of knew it was going to be tight for getting things set up, but we turned up and like they were just like taking down the bouncy castle for the area where we were going to be wrestling. And it was like, one, I'd never seen these bouncy castle things being taken down. So there was just like big long zips and they're unzipping it and like all the air was starting to come out. And then we all like start rolling it up and all the air is kind of pushing more and more in. So there's like staff from Bounce Station getting on it and like jumping on it and bouncing about everywhere. And there's Christmas music playing really loud. And it was just like watching Minions from Despicable Me, just like bouncing and rolling all over the place. I was like, what the fuck is going on? Me and Omar kind of, because we turned up together, killing kayfabe, sorry. But we just got in the building and we were just like, this is happening. And we start helping out. It's like looking at each other right now, like, this is crazy. Like, okay. We got all that down. We got it through, and then we're setting up the ring. Pretty handy that there's just like a shutter that they opened up, and then the van can get right in. And so the unloading was really quick. That was good. There's a little bit of difficulty getting the ring up. So like we had a few things just change on us on the day. Like I think I was meant to be going over, and that's what we kind of thought and planned the whole match around. And then apparently on the day it changed actually to Omar going over, so we'd like planned this whole match and I'm like, oh shit, we need to change it. And it was like at the same time, because the ring took longer, the people helping out were meant to be on second, so they moved them to third and put me and Omar into second. We're like, shit, we now don't have time to replan shit, fuck, all right, let's just get ready and get going, and we'll do this for a finish instead. And it wasn't, I think the match was all right, but I don't like my matches just being all right. So I'm kind of like, no, there's more to come definitely there, I think. I think me and Omar both are like, yeah, no, we can do better than that. I think we did fine, like I said, but we're both not guys who like to just do fine. That's probably why I'm getting about all these places as well, I guess, because, you know, some people are fine with fine. Not for me. It's kind of been one of those like, nah, I need to go back and show them what Caleb's all about properly. Well, but I mean, Omar, I think performance-wise, everything's fine. It's just I don't think the story of the match is what we wanted. And, you know, it's important to tell a good story, and I just feel like we weren't quite there.
Omar was particularly proud to message me to correct me that it was a submission win that he got.
Yeah. Another thing, I'm not precious about like putting people over like with Vago or Omar or anything. It's like I don't understand. It's at this point, you know.
It's a job at the end of the day, isn't it? It's just
Coach, what was it? Adam Shane was backstage there though, saying like his he likes to tell people his fee for doing the job is a bit more than his fee for going over. So you know, I was like, I'll keep that in mind. I'm sure he's joking, obviously, but you know, I was like, oh, it's funny.
Just mind that if he ever books a show.
I'll remember that if he ever comes calling for a show he maybe does one day.
Logan did ask you, put in a question, fresh off the show at Pro 2, how did you feel things were, which you've answered, and will you be back?
Hopefully. I will say the crowd were brilliant. That was one of the loudest crowds. I don't know if it's just because I don't know if it's much maybe Ghost Irving or what, I don't know, but they were there was, I think I saw somewhere say 350 people in the crowd. Again, I didn't count, but it did seem like one of the bigger crowds that I've been involved in since COVID, you know, since lockdown kind of eased. And they were an awesome crowd, really good crowd. I'd love to, they were really loud and really reacted to a lot of my stuff and, you know, gave the right reactions for what we did. But I'd like to get even louder reactions out of them, I think, you know. Great fun to work there. Backstage, everyone was really nice. I've met so many people this year with wrestling, like, that I, you know, obviously haven't met or only knew of online or anything like that. And like, so many people have been like, they're really nice. Oh, they're really nice. Like, so many people are sound. And I don't know if it's just because maybe a lot of the pricks are gone or maybe just, you know, everywhere has good people that I'm working, you know, that all these places I'm going are filled with good people. I don't know.
Yep, the former seems to be quite a good indication for that. Bit of your actual wrestling journey, and then we'll see if I do the questions, because I'm checking the time. I'm thinking, this is a Saturday night. Let's try and not keep you as late, too late.
I've been off for a week and a half, so I've lost track of days. I've had time off work, so you can tell me it's Thursday, I'd believe you.
So fuck you, we're here till midnight. Of course, the showcase. FPWA did their showcase this week as of recording, and there was a bit of a surprising return for both those nights as you faced tenacious Johnny Lyons in the main event of the second night.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't think that would happen.
Talking about bucket list opponents, that was another one. That was, I've worked them in a tag match in Stonehaven, but we literally had like very little issues. I think we had one tiny little spot together in that match. And I was green as fuck at that point. I was awful. I wasn't good. So funny thing about that match, actually, it's first time, I think it was one of my first tag matches I'd done. And I was meant to be tagging with Alan, but he had to drop out for whatever reason. So Zach Dynamite took his place. And it was like one of those, you know, where you don't really know each other. At that point, me and him hadn't done that much in training, so we didn't really know each other's shit too much. And he tagged me in, and then like just snapped Mare, I think it was Swift, down. And Swift was sitting, and I was at that point, I'd realized I don't know what I do when someone's in this position. So I gave him the shittest like kick, like boot, and he sold it, you know, probably too much because it was the drizzling shits. And then I was one of those things that like went and, you know, covered him, I think, and I was like down there covering him. I was like, that was fucking awful. I'm not doing that again. I'm gonna have to next week at training, I'm gonna figure out what I do when someone's in that position. Like, just like one of those things. Oh shit, I'm definitely still green and learning on the job here, am I? So we didn't have much great interaction in the ring before that, just that one little bit. I think I hit my finish on him, and that's about all me and him did. So he was excited. Well, let me do the Tuesday first. So the Tuesday night was me and Talon Jr. He is super, super talented. Like, he's one of the guys that in training, he just does these random, like, he'll do like a dive roll, and it's like the highest dive roll you've ever seen. And he just tucks the roll, and it's so quiet, and everything looks so effortless. He's just super athletic, super talented. He's got a big future. Yeah, he's only at 20. It's disgusting. I was like looking at him, I was like, at 20, I was drunk pretty much every night and not doing anything really athletic. I don't think I'd even start going to the gym at that point. So it's like, just disgusting to see how talented and good he is. And he should be everywhere. I think he just debuted at Reckless Intent, the second show I did. yeah, hopefully more to come from everywhere. And obviously debut, well, he was working a few other places, but then on the network now as well, pretty consistently. It's great to see and great to train with someone like that. So we had a pretty good match. I was working heel, and it's one of those matches. I think we came back, like, well, I say backstage, we had like a bus out the front of the academy. So the rings at the back of the academy, we had like rows of fans and friends and family, and then like the doors went out, and then everyone was in the van and the bus. Van's probably for a different company. So we were in the bus, and yeah, we both came out and we're in the bus afterwards, and we're both like, that's like one of the few times where we've had a match, and like you can think of nothing that went noticeably or like slightly wrong. It's just like everything that we thought just happened and on to the next thing. And it was, yeah, it was weird. I can't wait to watch that one back. I think there was a few clips up on obviously the FBWA Instagram story, but I'm looking forward to just watching that match as a whole. And then the Thursday, I find out it's Johnny Lyons, and I was like, oh fuck yeah. Like he was apparently hyped for it. He was ready to go. He like wanted to work me and see if he could still kind of go. And he can go. He can still go. He's in good shape. We put that together relatively quick. Went over it a few times and then like got out, and then he was on. And we were just started off just forearming each other, and you know, went into a run spot or something like that after, and like, if the forearms were nice and snug, he didn't mind me laying it in. He was laying his in. You know, we do a few things and we're kind of into the heat section. Again, I was working heel. And I, at one point, kind of, I think, yeah, we were getting close to like the end of the heat. I thought it was probably time for the comeback now. And I was like, right, gauge how he is. Like, because I'm thinking, this is a man, you know, mid-40s, hasn't really... You know, he retired 2 years ago. I'll just gauge it, see how he is, see how he's breathing, kind of thing. See if I need to like maybe pop on a little hold, let him get his breath before we go into the comeback. And I was like, nah, he's good. He's good. Let's fucking go. So like hook him up for a suplex, and then we do some stuff into the comeback. And yeah, the whole comeback and finishing sequence, he was there for everything. He was fired up. Yeah, man still got it. He's still got it. And again, like I said, a bucket list kind of opponent. I never thought I'd get singles with Johnny Lyons. I know Ryan Riley always talks about that being like one of his favorite matches he had with Johnny Lyons at Proving Grounds. And I came backstage onto the bus afterwards, and I was like, yeah, that's one of my favorite matches I've had as well. I don't know where it ranks. I don't know where they all rank yet, but that's one of my favorites for sure. Really good fun. And he was buzzing. He was like, honestly, it was like he just debuted. He was so buzzing afterwards. He felt great. We were laying shit in. There was a few forearms at the end. I was just like, I'm gonna murder him with this one because it needs to look good. And he was like, no, it felt great. I feel great. Is like you're saying, he'd had some like previously he'd had back problems, and I think he'd had like a knee issue at some point. And he said they both felt great. Hopefully he still feels great. Hopefully it's not just adrenaline and the next day he woke up broken. But yeah, no, it was one of those. It was great fun. We were both fine. Everyone was safe, and got a great reaction from everyone that, you know, Johnny Lyons was back wrestling there and, you know, hanging with me. So.
But it was really nice to see the pictures of him wrestling again, and I know they no doubt would have been calling all his moves as he used to.
Yep, for sure. Yeah, it helped. I knew what was coming once or twice because he called it. So it's like, all right, okay, I'll move.
it's weird though, because when it comes to Johnny, I mean, when you think of wrestling as a whole, when people call their moves, you do watch it sometimes and go, well, you know what's coming. But it seems to me with Johnny it works because he's so intense, and it's almost like he calls the move and then part of your brain goes, yep, that's where I'm just gonna sit here then, because I think if I move he might come and batter me like I'm be talking in a cinema, you know. Yeah. His cinema rants have ruined the cinema experience for me slightly, because there was a couple of people moon facing at Spider-Man, and I was too emotional about Spider-Man anyway, but I thought in any other mindset I'd be looking at, I was staring at him going, get that fucking phone off now.
tell you, Scottish Thieves Rants and Reviews would not enjoy a baby and me screening at Montrose Playhouse, I'll tell you that.
God, I could just imagine. You'd probably see him in the distance, just like red-faced and glowing.
Farting on a baby.
Look at you! You shot yourself!
Yeah, you shot yourself. Stop crying!
Has to happen now.
He's some guy. I tell you, he needs to come to a baby me screening with me. That's it. Just so I can watch him. Nah, he's a good lad. He's a brilliant guy. I was quite sad. I missed his retirement as well, because that was Christmas Chaos 2019. That sounds like a really long time ago now.
Yeah, that's probably right. So that's a scary thing.
And that was obviously when I'd been sent to Africa by Alan, so I didn't. I missed his retirement day and. And getting the belt and everything, so that was something I was sad I missed, but it was what it was, I guess. But I did send him a message just to say, you know, I was glad I could make it kind of thing, but you know, hopefully it went well, etc. Blah, blah, blah. So
even if it's just the showcase matches, it's the world's always a good place to have Johnny Lyons wrestling in it somewhere.
Oh yeah, that would be worth coming down just for to see Johnny Lyons. So
I know. Well, Andy did message me just saying if he wanted to come down and come to it. I don't think he realised how far away I am from it. But I was like, no, if I finish work, by the time I actually get there, the show will be finished. It'll be over. So I don't think I'll see it. But as soon as it comes up online, I've heard it's been filmed, like you're saying as well. So hopefully we'll go online and it'll be good.
I'll hopefully be able to share the match with Johnny myself if they don't share the whole show, but I mean they might just share the whole shows just so it's out there for everyone to see the guys that are training and putting in the work and you know getting these opportunities there and here and wherever. Obviously there's a few guys debuted at Discovery, there's a whole heap of guys kind of debuted at ICW now from FBWA, so yeah, it's a great place to train. Andy's a great coach. He really pushes people. He's in there kind of not barking orders, but he's like encouraging. He's doing it with you. He's sweating as well, you know. Although he still makes everything look so seamless and easy, he's phenomenal. So it's great to just kind of be there, see him doing that, and know that's what you need to be doing. So yeah, great place. Great young guys coming through. Some slightly older guys as well, myself included. Still busting our ass and hanging with those young guys who are super athletic and talented, and yeah, it's a great mix, a great blend.
Speaking of FPWA then, so the first question I've got here that came in was from Lewis, of course, training at the FPWA. He's just put, who would you want to wrestle from FPWA? So we'll take the coaches out of the equation, because I assume they'd be quite high on the list. But okay. Anyone that you train with or are part of the student.
Like I said, Talent Jr. is phenomenal. I'd love to have a match with him, you know, on a show. He makes everything look so good. When I think we had Alan from Discovery in one time just to watch some stuff, and I think that was one of the things he said, it was almost too entertaining watching me throw about Talon Jr. because he just made everything look so good. The way he flies about for you, it's like, oh, I'll give you a little pop-up, little pancake slam thing, and he almost hit the roof with it. It was unbelievable how high he got. Like, obviously I boosted him a good bit, but he had a good spring on himself there, and I was like, Chris, we maybe should temper that in this building, because it's not a high ceiling in that building. So yeah, it'd be great to do that on a show where we've got, you know, plenty of space above head, see how high we can get him. That's the obvious one, but then like there's a lot of the guys coming through. I absolutely love Frank Gallo. If anyone hasn't checked out his like vignettes and promo stuff online, go check him out. His character's brilliant. He's hilarious. I pop for everything he does, pretty much. Then there's so many others, like Tommy Cartel, there's Robbie Balfour, there's Callum McLean, Ross Hunter. You can bleep out if we don't want his real name popped out. But yeah, Ross Hunter, fantastic as well. And so young. I think he's only just turned 18. And it's like, he's that good at 18. When he's like 20 odd, 30, he's going to be unbelievable if he sticks at it. But he's 18, so maybe he'll find drinking women and it'll all come crashing down. Hopefully not. Hopefully he seems like he's got a sensible head on him, which will help. And obviously a good coach in Andy and all that. So, and I'm probably forgetting heaps of other guys. And there's some good women coming through there. Obviously you've had Harmony Sky on. I think there's another two training there all the time right now. Like they are just, there's another two women. That's where he debuted at Discovery.
Daisy Jenkins is the other one, was it?
Yeah, Daisy Jenkins is the other one. She's again, for the amount of time she's been training, she's definitely got something in there. Beth Shorty debuted at Discovery. Who, the two of them, as well as Morgan, all three are at the training school. They're there all the time. They're doing, you know, seminars here and there. Yeah, so they're putting in the work. So everyone
is spoiled for choice.
Busting it. Yeah, you really couldn't pick just one, but if I have to, I'd probably say Talon Junior just to see how high I can throw him.
Fine. So I've got Neil with a very interesting question here. Would you be willing to trade all the days from this day to that for one chance, just one chance to come back here and tell our enemies that they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom?
Yes.
Very simple answer.
Yes.
We've got Stone Malone. Has to be asked. Favorite McFlurry?
Oh, they did a Malteser one for a while, did they? Or is that
they
still
did.
One?
I thought I imagined it. They did do it. Thank God there's someone else that believes that as well.
That was the one. That was the one. I ain't taking any of those if I've got a Malteser option.
That's fair. Smarties is my go-to usually, but yeah, Malteser okay. One. Malteser is getting bought.
It must have just been a seasonal one or something.
And I think now it'll be probably after eight, which I don't mind minty chocolate, but I wouldn't pay for it.
I'm a bit annoyed that McDonald's aren't doing bagels or breakfast wraps for breakfast anymore.
Yeah,
it's only McMuffins, and I'm not a big fan of a McMuffin. I'd even take a McGriddle if they were doing McGriddles, but they don't do McGriddles here. So it's like, what, you've gave me one option, really. Or I guess they're starting doing just rolls, but they're nowhere near as good. Give me a bagel or give me a breakfast wrap.
Yeah, breakfast wrap. That was always my breakfast
pick. It was awesome. You got a hash brown in there. Brilliant.
Exactly. You got everything you needed.
Yeah.
And in one wrap. I mean, obviously, unless you got the new guy who went either a bit overboard or underboard with the ketchup.
Yeah,
you know, you needed that balance. Yeah. Need the vet to do it.
When you've got that sauce ratio just right, it's chef's kiss. It's, best. Yeah.
We've got Adam. I didn't think we'd bond so much about breakfast wrap, but Adam Hastings with, what powers does drinking from the horn bestow? Can mere mortals be trusted with it? Would Alan Sterling get the powers of Valhalla if he had it?
I severely doubt he would, but he'll probably try it at some point. Just that's probably going to end up happening at Summerhill, is it? No, he's probably listened to this and got that in his head. In fact, he did actually mention drinking from it at Christmas, but we didn't get around to it. So it might happen at some point. But I severely doubt he'll get any powers of Valhalla. He'll be, if anything, he may end up passing out, because that's some strong stuff in there. I ain't telling you what's in it, but it's some strong stuff. Nectar of the gods.
Irvin got it. As also asked, have you ever thought of a submission hold for your Arsenal? And if so, what would it be called? The Ragnarok Lock. And Dalen Hendry's also added the Ragnarok.
I love that name, but I'm trying to think of a submission. So I'm actually probably going to end hitting him up, because he is the man for submissions, I guess. But I do want like an upper body submission that I would call the Blood Eagle, based off like the way they kill people with the everything, ribs being broken out and all that kind of stuff. That would be like an upper body submission, but I just don't know what it would be yet. But I've got the name, so I'm set. Like, I need to get a Blood Eagle. But Ragnarok's fantastic. That's great. If I ever do an ankle lock, it'll be called the Ragnarok. Even if I only do it for one show, I'll shout it out. I'll Johnny Lines it for that one move. I say that I've started shouting out, like I do Gjallarhorn clubs, and it's just a club to the chest, and I shout Gjallarhorn and I bang. I've started shouting Crack-a-Doom when I give a German suplex sometimes.
That makes sense now, because I think you tweeted a GIF of that, and I was looking going, what? And now yeah. that all makes sense now. So yeah. Fine.
I just thought Crack-a-Doom's funny. That I enjoy that. And it comes back to having fun in there, and when I'm having fun, everyone else is hopefully having fun. So yeah, that kind of stuff. Even like I had a submission on hold on Johnny Lyons on Thursday, and instead of like, you know, everyone's like, yo, I'm like, yo, yield, that kind of shit. I was trying to have more fun with the kind of character specific stuff.
That's what I love about it, your character. It's like literally like Thor has come to Earth. And I don't know if you've seen Party Thor in Marvel's What If.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That's how I kind of imagine Caleb Valhalla to be. It's like, is on Earth and he doesn't quite understand what's happening, and like at Halloween hijinks when you got the kendo stick for the first time and you hit someone and you're like, oh, this is what happens. What that does. It starts smacking people more with it, and that's what I like, just being whether you are or not, you seem to be all in on the character during the show. You're just this guy who doesn't know how Earth custom works, and you're kind of figuring it out as the match goes on.
Yeah. So I'm glad that got across, because I kind of wanted that to get across with the kendo stick. I thought, if I'm going to use it, I'm going to pretend I don't know what this is, kind of, you know, oh, that's what that is. Yeah. You know, that's the kind of fun I was trying to have with that, and I'm glad that got across. So that's good. That's good to hear.
That's definitely in our corner of the hall. Anyway, it got across. I mean, even even while we were dealing with things like the pishy seat and all that kind of stuff.
Oh yeah,
the famed pishy seat.
Was that when Vago came out? Was that his fan club? But no,
must have been. It could have been.
Was it Kyle or Kaylee? Which one was it?
Are you starting to think that Kaylee might be saying, protesting too much that like, oh, there's a pishy seat. Yeah, it was her pishy seat.
That's it. Throw everyone off the scent.
Oh, that's a terrible way to put it. No, I did witness the pishy seat, so I do know it wasn't hers, unless she's amazingly can quickly swap seats. But it was a sight to behold. So that's
wrestling,
exactly. Yep. Speaking of like Ragnarok and Ragnarok and all that kind of stuff, have you seen Brock Lesnar's latest get up? Have you ordered your own set of dungarees?
Oh, it's dungarees. Yeah, well, maybe if me and Vago combine, that'll be what happens. I did love Vago's dungarees. I thought they were really good. I thought they really suited him, but
they're slimming, apparently. They're very slimming because they clearly put the work in. And
I have bought some dungarees, but it was before the whole Brock Lesnar thing. But it was because I was watching some old school, like 2000-2001 SmackDown, and X-Pac had some dungarees, and I thought, that's cool as fuck. I could rock that. So I do have dungarees upstairs. I've never worn them since getting them, apart from to try them on, being like, yeah, I like these. And I don't know why I've not put them on since, but probably because they're dungarees and I'm stupid and won't wear them in public, especially since when I put them on, I didn't have a t-shirt on. I was like this with dungarees, and I was like, that's probably how I want to wear them, but I probably shouldn't, especially not in this weather. So
I just feel like I'd look like one of the Godwins if I wore dungarees. Did he quickly agree with it? But okay. that's what I would look like. I would look like a Godwin.
No, you just popped me with that. I'm not going to agree with it. I'll be nice to you, but that popped me though.
Yeah, that'll be a vision that'll pop up in your brain. And during the night, you'll wake up thinking, oh God, Billy O'Godwin. Bog. That would actually fit.
It would.
Bog. Yeah, there we go. If the Godwins want to get back together, I could be your hillbilly Jim.
I'll book it. If I ever book anything, I'll book you for that.
Sorry, I charge more for jobbing.
You could be with outfit. You're their manager ringside.
I don't think that will happen.
Since they're farmers, you know, and you could be.
Ted doesn't like me. I don't think that'll.
Oh, Ted doesn't like anyone, but he's a lovely guy in reality.
Okay, I'll take your word for it.
Yeah, he'll never let you see it. But
oh yeah, sorry, he's blocked me. I'll never see it. So right. So we got Scotty. I'm not bitter about it, but it does sound like every time I mention it, I am. It makes me laugh that he blocked me. Scotty Swift, he's asked It's Always Sunny. You can only watch one episode. What is it?
I did see this, and this has killed me even thinking about it before this. There's so many. I don't know if you do you watch Always Sunny?
I got 6 seasons in. I didn't like it.
Oh man!
So I don't know. I just can't get into it. I hate all of them.
That's the point.
Which is the point, but it can't it doesn't override my enjoyment of the show. It's just I just hate them.
I love it. It's one of those shows I can just shove on in the background anytime and it'll cheer me up regardless. But I toiled, and I think I'm going to have to settle on Charlie Work just because it's a masterpiece. And it's an episode where the whole gang's got some stupid, plans going on, but the whole time Charlie is having to try and get them through a health and safety inspection, and he's got this really intricate thing he's got to do because the whole place is just there's no way they're going to pass. So he's got them all doing little bits and bobs here and there, but they're at the same time messing up their own plan, and he effectively does all this stuff. And I think there's one shot that's just all one shot all throughout. It's really well done, but it's just how you see Charlie's actually the brains of the operation, but he gets no credit for any of the work he does. It's magnificent. There's a few other episodes I could have picked, but I think that's the one I would vote for.
For me, I carried on until I got to The Nightman, because I hear that's the best one ever. It just does the musical.
All right.
And I watched it and I thought, I still don't get this. This is it. This is supposed to be the best one. I'm gonna have to give it up now. This is it. It's done.
That's fair.
But no, people can it's like wrestling. You can like what you like. It's all subjective. I'm not gonna judge anyone for liking it if I don't. That's how it should be in the end. Oh, Scotty also added fuck SWE and fire alarms discuss, which we've already went through. But if there's any further comment, allegedly. Mrs. Valhalla.
Get my John Cena booking. So,
come on, Ted, get the millions out.
I'm fine not even getting paid for it, because I won't.
Don't give him that offer.
I'm not going to get paid. So,
you'll get coffers in an envelope, allegedly. But I was going to say Ted might not be able to afford it now. Didn't he get done for fraud or tax evasion?
I heard. Wasn't it him and? Was it him and his sons? Two sons.
Was it Brett? I don't know if Teddy Jr. was part of it. I definitely know Brett was, I think. I say definitely, like I know these things. Allegedly.
I mean, you're in the business. You're the journalist. You tell me.
Oh, do not say that. That's awful.
Wrestling journalist Billy Strachan just confirmed.
a guy came up to me after a show once and said, I like Dave Meltzer. And I was like, fuck off. No. Get my star rating now. I'll 5 stars for the Bulgarian Baker. That is my remit of star ratings.
I don't think anyone leaks anything to you either. So,
but they do. But I'm quite nice, and I don't put it out because I think I just don't want to be that guy. Really,
I didn't know that was a thing. I'll start leaking stuff to you then, Billy. Don't worry. I'll get you the goss, inside goss.
Well, yeah. People have leaked information to me, and I'm just like, what benefit to me? It's Scottish wrestling. What benefit is of me putting this information out? None. There's no benefit. The only time is I did, as I put out ICW results after tapings, and people were furious about that. So I was like, then I won't do it then. That's fine. I'll just leave it and schedule it for 2 weeks.
Okay. So it's in line with the network stuff as opposed to, yeah.
Yeah, I got some shit for that from some people for doing that. But I got the results. What was I going to do with it? Put them out. But no, I just decided.
At least you're 2 weeks ahead of the game for that, then.
Exactly. I'll pick out matches I want to watch, but it just means I don't have to sit through it. I don't have to watch 2 hours to see these matches and put the results out. I've just got it all sorted. I can watch it at my leisure. I was really me skating, saying I don't watch it. I do, just I don't watch it on the day. Right, okay. So Mrs. Valhalla has got a bunch of questions. And then we'll finish on Kyle of K&K Wrestle Factory with his one. I think we added a new question to our set before. Did I ask you what your favorite dinosaur was?
Yeah.
Time?
Yeah,
I did. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Well, everyone go back and listen to the first one for that. So, Mrs. Valhalla, would you rather spiders in your butthole or go bald?
Yeah. But this is a recurring thing. Like, you know when you've got like scenarios like, oh, would you rather this or that? Like, it's always spiders in butthole with her, because she knows I hate spiders. So, you know, spiders in your butthole's pretty awful if you don't like spiders, I imagine. So that's always like her reference point of like, is this better or worse than that thing? So she messed this up, because I would rather go bald than spiders in my butthole, but I'd rather spiders in my butthole than have to shave my beard. So
there you go. Yeah.
So she went for the wrong part of the head.
Do you have a baby face? Like a proper, I look like a thumb.
Yeah. During lockdown, I like had a few drinks with one of my mates, and he likes to just fuck about with his facial hair. So he was like saying he was just going to shave this bit. And I was like, yeah, why not? That sounds fun. I'm not going to see anyone for months. So I did it, and I shaved this bit, thinking, you know, I'd be like, oh, I'll just end up looking a bit like, you know, Triple H or something, you know, when he did that. And then I realized, wow, my chin is like here. My chin is here, not down here. It's here. And I was like, wow, that looks awful. I'm never doing that again. My wife has never seen me clean shaven, ever.
I did it for a wedding once. I found out my chin's here. I've also got a second one here. And maybe a third hiding right about here. So I was like, no.
Yeah, I was peak pizza stage at that as well. So I did have a little bit of a second chin as well at that point. And it wasn't a good look. So my wife has now seen the bottom of my chin, but she still hasn't seen all this area.
Yeah.
So she won't. It's never going to happen.
That game I play, like that kind of scenario, is I ask Kelly, what would you keep? Your birthday, Christmas, or Halloween? And then the day after we got married, one of my first questions I asked her was, what would you keep? Your birthday, Halloween, Christmas, or your anniversary? She hates this game. And I still have not got an answer for it. So we've been married for 3 years now, and I've asked this question very regularly. So never got an answer.
Has she taken any of them off, like as she said, or is it all, they're all even?
They're all fairly even. I think she got Halloween once. One time I asked, mainly because she doesn't get a present for it. And it works out that our anniversary is October, Halloween's end of October, her birthday's end of November, and it's Christmas. So that's 3 months of, she planned this very well for getting an anniversary gift, birthday gift, and a Christmas gift. But so Halloween was the one that wavered because she didn't get anything for it, which I thought was fair. We gave it that one, but I still haven't got a concrete answer. Even if she turns around and goes, "Oh, I love Christmas," and I'll turn and go, "But if you had to choose one, which would it be?" So never end story. Also got, which Harry Potter character would you most like to wrestle?
Is this still from?
Is still from Mrs. Valhalla.
Which? That's because we just watched Harry Potter, I'm assuming, but. Any character?
I mean, I'm assuming Hagrid, is he out of the equation because he's a half giant?
Yeah, but at the same time, Caleb Valhalla wouldn't mind facing some giants. You know, he's faced giants before and on other realms. So, horse battle as well.
Victor Crumb. Maybe throw in Victor Crumb from Goblet of Fire.
Oh yeah. I reckon he could work heel and I could work face. Whereas Hagrid, I'd probably have to go heel. So we'll do that. We'll say if I'm working heel, I'll face Hagrid. And if I'm face, maybe Crum. No. I mean, wizards are using magic. It's a bit unfair as well. But would they be allowed to use magic? Is that a thing? Because then.
I don't know. Which one would you want to just punch in the face?
Which one would I pay? What was the one that took over the Hogwarts?
Umbridge.
Yeah,
that's fair.
Man, that actress is phenomenal, because I have never hated a movie character that much. I think, like, I just fucking despise her. Unbelievable job there, because if anyone's thinking, oh, what will I do for my heel character, just watch her, and that's take all those heel traits, because that I hate that woman more than anyone, and she's not even real.
Maybe even set off a fire alarm. She's just a. But no, we went down to Harry Potter Land Studios. Harry Potter Land studios, and yeah, she's got like a wee section of her pink guardian that, and just seeing it just enrages you. Just looking at it, just remembering how much of a bastard she is. Amazing. We've also got, again from Miss Valhalla, will I ever get my primer potion back now you have makeup in your gimmick?
I thought she gave it to me as a gift. I thought that's, you give someone, you don't explicitly say I need that back. That's, I think I've got two of her primers actually, and she got angry at me the first time I did my face paint because I didn't use the primer, and she was like, you need to use primer. I was like, are you serious? Like, I'll try it. I don't know if I notice any difference, but you know, if she's going to shout at me, I'll use it. So yeah, I also got, oh no, I didn't. To start with, I was going to, I took her eyeliner, but I've since bought my own eyeliner, so I've at least bought that. I could have just kept using hers, but
you just go for just the standard boots, or have you gone for Revolution, or have you went for a brand name?
Absolutely no idea.
No,
it was a black one.
I'm asking this like I would know the answer, just because every Christmas I like panic buy like Revolution makeup or something because I know Kelly likes it. I don't know what the colors are. They're terrible.
Oh yeah,
that'll do.
I'll say I use an eyeshadow for the lids because the face paint actually kind of comes off a little bit once you've like opened your eyes and blinked like twice. It's like starts wiping away a bit. So use some eyeshadow on there. I've got my eyeliner. It's like I'm back in the band days, being a goth boy. So
I have heard you had a bit of a goth past. One of Kelly's pals she's met called Stacey.
Oh yeah, yeah, I know.
Yeah. Stacey. Yeah, yeah. She did mention that
small world
that you're a big goth in your youth.
Yeah.
So I thought I'm not going to mention it until you mentioned being a goth. I was like, that's fine. I've got the info.
There we go.
But no, that is such a weird small world when all that kind of collides, and meeting someone randomly and turns out they know someone that wrestles and I know them as well, so here we are. How weird. And the last thing she's put out is she's put out a word I can't say. It's obligatory, but it doesn't sound right in my act. I can't say it. Obligatory, please get rid of some of your t-shirts.
Oh, okay. So we've got rid of like five or six. No, actually, it was more. I got rid of 8 t-shirts on our last call, which must have been after she sent this question in, because I have a lot of t-shirts. I like t-shirts.
I've got a suitcase in the loft now. That's where all my t-shirts go when they no longer fit, because the XXL on this t-shirt sums up my life. So so I've got ones that I'm like, I don't want to throw away, because I might fit into them again.
Yep, I'm the same. I had a suitcase in the loft before with different size t-shirts, but then we've culled a lot of that. Most of the bigger sizes are gone now, because I was fat for a period of time a few years ago. I think I was up to like 253 pounds at my heaviest, so I'm about 220 now, and I was not I was not as muscular at that point as well. I was still relatively strong.
Double check what that is in kilograms. I might have a wee cry just to double check. 253 pounds. Ah, fuck you.
Yeah.
I'm that now.
All right. Well, my waist looked bigger than yours, I would say.
I wear it well.
I think it's that t-shirt you're wearing. It's clearly
must be. That's the power.
Making you look so good. That's it. That's the power of Valhalla right there. So but yeah, that was me at my biggest. And then like I had to just accept, even if I get as muscular as I want over the next however many years, I'm probably not gonna be that big, because I'm 5'10 barefoot, so I must be about 5'11 in my boots, I think. So even if like I got to 253 again, I don't think I would fill the t-shirts the way I thought in my head back then when I bought them. I was like, I'll get them in this size because I want to get that big. Like, nah, I probably won't actually get that big, as well as it would be like so long, it'd be dumb. So
that's the issue I've got a terrible body shape with 2XLs are too big. XLs are just too small, so I'm like when you get the jean sizes, I'm an odd number. So yeah. I'm not a 38. I'm not a 40, because that's too big. I'm like a 39.
See, Hollister are good for that. Hollister have got their in-between sizes. they're good for that. Nowhere else does though. Like, why don't you have the in betweens?
I know. So yeah, that's.
It's like too big, and you wear a belt, you get that weird little, like, kinky bit sometimes. It's like,
I know. And then I've got fat thighs but really thin calves, so I can't wear proper. I have to really pick jeans because either they don't fit, so I've got to belt them, or they look like flares because my calves are so thin. And
you're probably the same as me. You probably got to try on your jeans before you buy them.
Yeah, and then by that point, I've got two pairs of jeans that I know fit, that I like. That's the jeans I wear for everything. So first function of people I meet, first jeans, second pair. Oh, they must have loads of jeans. Third meeting, oh, he's only got two pairs of jeans. That's skinny. I mean, third
time,
work.
It could just be chance. It could just be by chance, you know, that the third time you're wearing the same pair again or whatever.
Skinny
works
for
me. Skinny's worked for me because of the stretch on it, like thigh problems for me generally. So the stretch, phenomenal. I can move in a pair of stretchy jeans, thankfully.
Yeah, I held off so long in skinny jeans because I thought by the time I did, I was like, I'm 28, I'm too old for skinny jeans. And then I got them, I was like, oh my god, this is the best thing.
I think it was about the same. I did the exact same thought process, I think. So yeah. Never looked back.
So yeah, it's absolute game changer. Well, except now it's joggers. Joggers and shorts, because I don't leave this house.
Yeah, exactly. Why not?
It's the best. Every time this is put an email around going, oh, what people think about coming back to the office? No, I'm comfy now. I have shorts. I have joggers. I'm happy.
I'm the same. Like my work's been discussing that as well. And obviously now, I don't think it's definitely going to happen now, obviously. But before, they were like putting out feelers, like maybe we could have, you know, a few people in. And I'm like, cool. Yeah, you can have a few people in. I'm not going to be in because I do the exact same job. I do it just as efficiently. You can see I do the same job in the same amount of work. Like we've got, you know, it all tracked. My workload hasn't went down at all. I've just kept turning stuff out. So like no point in dragging me in to then make me have to think about, oh, what about childcare now? And then I'd probably like struggle to go up to Aberdeen for work to then go down to Fife to train. That's a lot of travel. Would I make it? I don't know. Probably couldn't afford that much on fuel because, I went down 4 days a week with work as well, just with the baby because, you know, important to get time with her. And when I was working 5 days a week as well, we did that for a few weeks before it all went through and was confirmed. But even those few weeks, it was like 5 days a week. By Saturday, I'm getting time with her and it's almost like we're having to start again every week. Mm-hmm. Whereas now I'm getting time with her all the time. And yeah,
I think it
makes a big difference.
I mean, I changed jobs. I used to be in the Elgin office and then we all got sent home. So I'm still in the same company, but technically I'm supposed to go to Aberdeen. And that's that if everything opens up again. Yeah. And Aberdeen's expensive to get. I mean, Elgin to Aberdeen, it's 100 miles a day. It's £300 a month on fuel, if you're lucky. Yeah. And it's just like, no, I'm happy just to be here.
It's not a good road either. It's a horrible journey. Or if you're on the train, trains are ridiculously priced. So. Or is there trains even up there? I don't know.
Do you have trains? There is a train, Elgin. But I have to go a train to Elgin. I have to go Elgin to Aberdeen, and then it's in Blackburn. So I have to get a bus.
Oh, Christ.
It's no point to do this. But I'm holding. I'm going to stay in this. I mean, also, the longer that I'm working from home, the more I'll do podcasts because I don't have to travel home. I don't have to, because it's a knackering journey as well. And you'll know yourself from traveling about. Obviously, you obviously have the work outside of it. I don't. I'm just sitting on my arse and then I'll drive. But it's a lot more work than you think it is, just sitting on your arse driving for an hour and a half to one place and then doing it twice a day. Last question I've got is from Kyle from K&K Wrestle Factory. It's quite a simple one. He just put, can you ask why stupid sexy Caleb is so sexy? What are your thoughts on the stupid sexy Caleb?
I popped for it. I didn't like... That was hilarious. When I saw it, they titled the review that, I was like, I've got to share that. Yeah, I can't just scroll past that. So that popped me. That gets a few mentions on the mosh pit as well. It's weird. Like if he thinks I'm, you know, sexily, stupidly sexy. That's fine. I appreciate that compliment, Kyle.
I could hear you just so like bashful about it. It's like, no, fuck you.
I was like, oh shucks, oh Kyle, you. Yeah, I mean that's generally me. I'm not good at taking compliments, anyways. But you know, thanks, Kyle. You know, he's not a bad looking guy either. So you know, this is when like me and Kyle have got a thing going on to rival Vago and Kaylee, obviously. So you know, he can be my fan, he can be my number one fan, and then you know we can compete for best wrestler in Montrose. You know, with best our fans ringside.
There you go.
You know, I've got my second account. I say that he's probably a bigger Vago fan than he is a Caleb fan, so I'm still fucked. So.
Well, it's got to get Vago nowadays. It's got to get your own podcast.
And that's it.
That's with blackjack and hookers. Actually, forget the podcast.
I've got the same problem. I hate my voice, so it's like I don't know if I could do what you're doing.
Oh yeah, I don't listen back to these. That's why. what I do for a lot of people is, well, now I do is I send them the video afterwards and go, right, if there's anything you want taken out, let me know. Because pretty much I'm not listening to it again. I know that it's fine. As long as like if I check the waves, as long as it doesn't kill entirely, like something's gone wrong, then I don't listen back to these. It's just, oh, it's horrible. Although I did listen back to the one with Scotty because I had to sweeten the audio because I didn't realize that Zoom cuts the audio when you play something on screen. So I had to put it back on because I mean, I don't want to spoil it for you, but a certain promo has come resurfaced the last couple of weeks that we had to put out, and I felt damn good about it when I put it on there.
There we go. Good.
So that makes an appearance, but I think we're over 2 hours now, and we're approaching Swift levels of chat. And You've done quite a few podcasts now, two with myself, of course, this one and the one previously, and you're quite a regular guest now on the Mosh Pit. So I'm sure if anyone wants to find out more about Caleb Valhalla, and I didn't even mention, of course, becoming a father, but you did that quite in detail with Vago, and I think he's a better person to speak to about it because he has kids as well. I have a dog. It's not the same thing.
So, hey, just as much work, I'm sure. I mean, I've had dogs before, but I've never had like a dog where I'm the, you know, it's like my mom and dad's dog. So like, I could imagine raising a dog would be just as tough at various points, with the negative of at some point the dog won't be able to talk and tell you what's wrong. You just have to always figure out what's wrong with the dog.
Yeah.
Although saying that, dog can't talk back other than barking. So I've got that talking back stuff to look forward to, I guess. And if she's anything like me or her mum, then we're fucked.
The dog has learned if she hits her face against the cupboard in the lobby, then she'll get a treat or she'll get walked. So it's 50-50 whether which one I think's right. And usually if it's pissing rain, it's treat. We'll just go treat for that.
Yeah.
So
that's fair.
Last time we spoke, we had the dinosaur question. That was our regular question, but we have added one since, and it's quite simply, what do we win in a fight, 2 sheep or 1 cow?
Oh yeah, this one. I go back and forth on this, so I'm just gonna roll with cow today. Just like I'm picturing more like a Scott Steiner and like 2 vanilla midget sheep, so he's just gonna squash him. Well, I guess.
Fair enough.
There we go. That's what I'm thinking.
That's the last question. Usually, we try to be the last question out during match, but someone's already swooped in and taken that question away from us, so we'll leave that there.
Yeah.
Is there still merch? I was noticing there's a new Caleb Valhalla t-shirt. It's this design, but in red.
Yeah, very limited. I think we have like at most 4 or 6 of them. I didn't expect them to sell quite as well. Even the grey ones, I'm kind of running out. Apart from, I just got some kids' t-shirts in because I think it was the first Reckless Intent show. There was like 3 kids wanting t-shirts, but they were far too small for the small men's sizes. So I was like, yes, I gotta get kids finally. So especially as I'm working face and more of these family shows, it's like, yeah, probably sensible to get some kids' shirts. So we got kids' shirts now available. I think I've sold 2 of them already, so I need to check. I didn't get many of them either, so even those sizes are kind of limited. So the reds, super limited. I think one or two sizes are all gone. So if you want a red one, hit me up and let me know your size and I'll check the box of shirts. I need to have thoughts of more merch as well. If this is these shirts almost kind of run through, I can always reprint, I guess, but probably only a limited life cycle on each t-shirt, I guess. So need to get more merch in general. I need to get, like, everyone keeps telling me I need to get pictures printed off. So I suppose I should do that. I'd love to get some stickers because I've just started putting stickers on my gear bag. Because at Bounce Station, there was a sticker in the office, and I was like, "Oh, I need a Bounce Station sticker because this was a hell of a show. I'm going to get this for the memory. I've got a Discovery sticker on there. I've got one or two others.
But you know what? I'll send you one of mine as well.
Oh, yes, that'll go in the bag as well.
I've got a podcast one or just a plain SWN one. So you can take your pick. They're available for everyone else. They're available for £2 on Tmall. Okay. So you can find them free delivery start of the month on weekends. But no, I'll take your address afterwards and I'll send you them.
Nice.
No other reason to use them.
I'll send you a picture once they're on. So yeah, I need to do that. I got one for Killer Customs as well. She did my new ring gear. So I'm really, really happy with how that looks. And she sent a sticker along with that. I was like, oh, that's going on the bag.
I've got the same. My laptop is starting. I've got a Grant McIver one. I've got a Ric Flair one somewhere. Because it's like, if anyone sends you stickers with their merch, I'm like, yes, on the laptop it goes. Yep. Even though the laptop is still slowly dying.
Yeah. Same laptop.
Oh, yeah, but now
the little engine that could.
I now use my work. Allegedly, I use my work computer for the actual recording, and then I use the laptop for the top and tailing and uploading. So it's got less work for it to do, but it's still surviving. I don't know how, but there we go. Anyway, so we've hit over the 2-hour mark. Like I say, we're almost into Swift territory, and I'm sure we'll still have plenty. Chat for a third episode in the future, no doubt.
Yeah, there's more debuts coming next year. There's a lot of shows lined up next year, so we'd have heaps to talk about, I'm sure, 6 months, a year's time, whatever.
Excellent. Maybe we'll get you on board for the next birthday quiz I do for next year. Day of Birth Bonanza, not Birthday Bash.
I'm awful at quizzes, as I'm sure you've seen in the previous Mosh Pit quiz and the one that's coming up. Quizzes are not my forte, but I'll happily come along at some point if I'm available and someone's got to come last.
Once you listen to Ryan and Connor attempt to do a movie quz, then you might feel a bit better about
maybe giving that go.
But we'll wrap this up then. Where can people find you on social media?
I believe I'm at Caleb Valhalla everywhere. No one else has taken that, so yep, that's it. At Caleb Valhalla on Twitter, Instagram, and I think Facebook as well.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, cheers for having me.